Hey, JQ.
Yes.
You know why I'm wearing these sunglasses?
Why is that?
Because what I learned this weekend is that winners wear big sunglasses like this. And I want to be just like the Viking. So I got
You know why I'm wearing sunglasses?
Because you got a prescription.
Because you can't see if I get tears in my eyes.
Oh, good excuse. But you know what? I want you to watch this video because I'm really proud of this. And I thought this set the stage for an awesome weekend for everybody. But I condensed this from 24 minutes to this 1 minute and 28 seconds. So check it out.
Tried some tires for Ronnefalk there. Now we know that he shouldn't run them.
With the invisiblespeed.net, and thank you for sponsoring the show. Can this be a good track to learn setup on, or is it
really good for learning setup? Because you can really tell the difference. Some things are, interestingly though, opposite. Go to higher grip, you go to a thicker anti-roll bar. Too high grip, so then it starts going the opposite way. When you get to a track like this, which is smooth and really high grip, some of your basic knowledge doesn't actually work. So his car is actually handling well because run low roll centers. You can see there's no tendency of it traction rolling. The most common error are just the very basic. Course is structured is, it's really good for any level of experience. When it says it's a full course, it really is. Set your idle gap, that's number one. Makes it easier. It's like juggling with two balls instead of three.
Invisiblespeed.net.
We have a discount going on this week. Euro discount, 20% off. This week on. It's in English, available already, and it's being translated this summer by Robert. Nemesis is in this race. He told me that if Jessica Paulsson beats me, he's going to force me into retirement. She beat me both rounds. To be honest, I've always wanted to have green hair. Jessica Paulsson with a good time, be tough to beat. She might put me into retirement. They get the discount, but also we're going to have a 1 week long live just for them. Only the people who sign up now.
That was pretty good. You have to admit, that was pretty good. I know you didn't even watch that.
I did watch. Thank you.
You just don't like it. That's what it is. But anyway, you know what? We got a lot to talk about today. We got a lot to talk about. I'm going to do my thing. I'm going to come back. We got the now 3-time world champion coming on later on to tell us about his race. European champion. See, I'm getting excited. I'm ready for seeing the future. 6 years from now. Joseph, take off your sunglasses. I'll take off mine. We got a lot to talk about. I'm going to drop that intro, and we'll be back to talk Euros and all that good stuff.
Nitro is the glory, but eBuggy pays the bills. Welcome to the No Name RC Podcast. Get ready for some serious bench racing. But be warned, we speak our minds, express our thoughts, and sometimes things can get a little rowdy.
Hate, and he just was influenced by the hate coming from the left, the hate coming from the right.
And let's get back to more club racing and less of this money-grabbing book racing.
Hard not to be arrogant when you're always right.
Yeah. See what I mean? That's exactly why people call you arrogant, Max.
You may not agree with everything we say, but it's definitely worth a listen.
And our pick, can you stop whatever you're doing?
Join your host, Lefty the Great, with co-hosts and guests as they get together to chat RC.
Hey, after that race that I watched this morning, I have to talk about it.
Here we go. $100 right here, $100 throw. Oh no!
I like this.
Yes, indeed. Nitro is the glory, but eBuggy pays the bills. What's going on, everybody? Welcome to episode number 198 of the No Name RC podcast. I'm your host, Keno White, a.k.a. Lefty the Great, and he's in the background drinking, I believe, but he'll be on later in a few minutes. But we've got Reverse Beaker, who's all excited and emotional about winning his Euros. Not only that, he's fully retired now. quote retired. We'll figure that out anyway. But yes, everybody, we are two episodes away from our 200th episode. It's going to be good. We're going to plan that next week. We got a lot of giveaways for you guys, so talk more about that later. And yeah, we got a lot to talk about this week. It's all about the Euros. We're only talking about what happened because Joseph was there. We wanted to do it while it's fresh. We will have David coming on at some point to talk with us as well. So when he comes on, we'll stop what we're doing so we can talk to him, get his thoughts on it and all that good stuff. But anyway, hey, what a great Euros. We're going to talk all about it. I can't wait. With that said, I just wanted to say thank you to all of you guys, the NNRC squad around the world. Without you guys, we can't do this. We greatly appreciate your support. Also, shout out to the patrons of the podcast. You guys will get early release of this. Thank you guys for the support. If you guys wish to become a patron of this podcast, you can. The link is in the written description of this podcast. Also, big thank you to all of the sponsors. Remember, everybody, supporting this, showing the sponsors some love, shows the podcast some love. We have coupon codes, affiliate links, or just we have links to all of our sponsors. Even if they don't have an affiliate link or coupon code, leave them a message and say, hey, I heard about you on the NNRC. Nitro is the glory. And eBuggy pays the bills. We greatly appreciate all support. And yeah, we need you guys to help us out there. Shout out to Invisible Speed. We saw that all this weekend on the Euros. Joseph, for sure, will talk more about that. TZO 200 tires. They're going to be a big part of our 200th episode next week. I'm talking to Nick. He's all pumped and ready for the grand launch of TZO 200 tires. High Tech RCD, thank you to High Tech for all the support. TNR Fuel, shout out to Chris and his family. So they've been racing at the JBRL this past weekend. Mayako, of course, Mayako is right. Shout out and congratulations to all the NPC guys. I know you guys are excited. Beach RC, shout out to Brent and Lucas and those guys. See you guys soon. Techno RC, Lugs Racing Tires, G-Spec RC Racing Tuning for all your cabling needs, Papa Willie's Traction Tonic, Sun Pedal USA for your battery needs. Going to be using them very shortly. Racecraft USA, Clinic RC, RCGP UK coming up, guys. Don't forget that. House of RC, DR Race Shop, JTP RC. And yeah, shout out to just everybody that supports us. We greatly appreciate that. Before I go on any further, I just wanted to throw out some race announcements that we have coming up. Obviously, we have the Vision Race coming up this weekend. I'm excited to see what they do. I think Joseph and I will talk about that. The list of pros has grown. I think they got about 12 pros going on. That's pretty good. Also, the ENATS is on this weekend. Unfortunately, it looks like a very low turnout. I hope that changes and people go. We will see. And we got some upcoming races. That's what you can watch this weekend, by the way. We got some upcoming races here shortly. We got the Peach State Classic, the Georgia Peach State Classic that's coming up on the, let me get the date here. Hold on for a second. The 16th to the 18th of September, so the week after the Worlds, it'll be held at the Raybon Arena in Bog Mountain Tiger, Georgia. So hit up Mark Moon, $75 per class. It's in a covered area, so it's like Wicked Weekend. It's got open sides with a cover top. Best type of indoor track you want to go to, so it's lots of circulation. And these guys know how to put on a good race, know how to build great tracks, and shout out to Mark Moon and all them guys. And you guys should check it out if you're looking for an indoor race to go check out. Also, RC3 in Huntsville, Alabama invite you to join them on August 6th and 7th for their 13th annual Rocket City Challenge presented by Futaba. Averaging over 200 entries annually, the Rocket City Challenge is one of the South's premier outdoor off-road races. With a two-day race format, you're able to enjoy a laid-back racing atmosphere while battling it out with some of the fastest racers on the East Coast. This race also features fun events like a buddy race, the Pit Stop Challenge, all of this happening on Saturday nights to give racers a fun way to wind down from a long day of qualifying. With grand prize giveaways like a Futaba 10PX and a HB E819 RS, this is one event you won't want to miss. Check us out on Facebook at RC3 Racing for more information or visit us online at www.rc3racing.com. Yeah, so we got some races coming up for you guys. If you want to hit up some big regionally national races, you can check those out. But yeah, hey, you know what? Joseph, I'm going to bring you in because we got some somber news we need to talk about real quick before you go get all excited. Well, what's up there, Mr. Green Hair? Like, that's what everybody was talking about all weekend was your hair.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you gonna
positive or what?
Well, I mean, you just have green hair. Like, even my wife was like, "What's wrong?" She's like, "Oh, what's look at with? Joseph. It's got green hair." I was like, "Yeah." She goes, "Why did he choose green? Oh, this is his favorite color."
Yeah.
Always but wanted lots of attention, hair. Lots of attention. But before we go on, Joseph, some somber news. Actually, we touched on this last week, but we had two recent deaths in the industry. One was David Church. He passed away last weekend. So condolences to him and his family. He used to be an announcer, I think announced for Live RC. And he did work with RC Racing TV at some point, big into 10 scale. And I believe yesterday or this weekend, Ernie Provetti, dude, 69 years old, passed away. Man, that is like a big, that's an icon in the industry, though. Like, Ernie's going.
I never met him.
Me neither. I would have loved to have that guy here on the podcast. I bet you he has some great stories.
I believe he does.
I bet you he has some gangster stories. He seemed like a gangster. Condolences to, and a gangster, I mean, like, just, you know, like, just the stories that I've heard and all that stuff. He did what it needed to be done to make things happen. But condolences to his family, to the Trinity family and all that. Man, I really wish I would have gotten him on the podcast. I used to hear, I did hear him on one podcast. I think he went on the Radio Impound podcast with Gotti and Rona. And then I believe that Gotti used to work for him back in the day. So you always heard he has some stories about Ernie, and it was really touching to see how many people like really that knew him and got involved with him throughout the years. So when you've been in RC that long, you know, and you've been, just Trinity versus Reedy, all those vicious like battles back in the day, like, and all that rivalry, like, it's wow, it's crazy. Like, to think that another icon like that's gone, like Reedy went and now he's gone. Reedy went a few years ago. But yeah, unfortunate, man. Unfortunate. A lot of RC history just went with that man. You know what I mean? Wow.
We're getting old.
Yeah, I really feel sorry for his family and the Trinity family, man. And I just hope I just remember seeing him in the magazines and all that type of stuff and just seeing Trinity everywhere and wanting that stuff so much. Like, it was so back in the day, like, it was such a, like, that was the cool, it was so hard to get to. Like, I was like, how do people get this stuff? Like, but wow, incredible, incredible. Condolences, our condolences. All right, JQ, you know what? Before we go on any further and get into the nitty gritty of things, I think we're going to have a word from one of our sponsors. What do you think?
Why not?
GP loves Great Britain. So much so, on August the 5th, 2022, we're coming home for some British hijinks and all-out Nitro Buggy racing action.
Yeah, we got RCGP coming up in 3 weeks' time. Who from the UK is going to come? Is Musso coming? He wasn't at the Euros. I was shocked to see he wasn't. Or was he?
Oh, yeah. No, he wasn't. Yeah.
Shocking that he wasn't at the Euros. It was a lot of drivers at the Euros that I was shocked. Not so much Craig, because he did the week.
Four guys, week. I guess. Musso, yeah. Craig, Valente, and Polito.
Where was Valente? What happened?
I don't know.
He was so fast. Like I had him going into the main.
It could have been, possibly.
I had him in the main after RCGP. Anyway, JQ, hey, you know what? First off the bat, congratulations to our friend, the Viking. He got it done. He got it done. He got it done. I was so nervous. So nervous.
Me too.
Yeah, I know you was.
I had dampened the nerves a bit with like 7 vodka Red Bulls and a bunch of beers. So that helped. Well, I don't know.
Maybe yeah, but seven. You started maybe that for... You started that because of your retirement.
Yeah, that too.
Yeah, you started early.
Yes.
So
as soon as I was retired and David had everything he needed, he didn't need me anymore. It was all in his hands. That's when I started.
Dude, I shit you not. I literally said on the pre-show, right? I was like, David cannot allow, like, I saw this kind of playing out in my brain. I saw it, and if Burak would have been there, I think he would have been involved too. But I just saw Canas, Coelho, Ongaro pulling away, right? Even if and David would be in there too. And I was like, he cannot let those three guys, or cannot let Canas and Coelho pull away. If he does, then he's going to get too far behind. He's going to be battling in the back of the pack, and he's not going to be able to apply pressure. Wow. Hey, I was like, you could see he was faster, and he was just pacing himself behind him at first. And I was like, oh, yeah, he can get. I said, he's either just hanging back there in third, comfortable, waiting for them to make a mistake. And then, oh, man, and I saw that he had better fuel mileage. Well, Coelho and him had similar fuel mileage. But, wow, man, congratulations to you too, man. Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's fucking awesome, dude. You just won the fucking Euros. Like, do you know how fucking big that is?
Yeah, I do.
Dude, that was so awesome. Oh, so nervous. I was just, it was like when Max won DNC. I was like just sitting here, rocking back and forth. You know, like getting right down to the end. You know how it's always been with David? Like always something near the end of the race. RCGP, damn receiver, dust stops working. DNC, okay, it wasn't near the end, but he was clearly faster than everybody. Strikes something, a light pull. You know, it's all 2015 world, you know, he could have won it. What happened? I mean, the Euros. Lost a servo. Man, show something. Or did you use all your emotions up on Sunday? Yeah, I think you did. That's what it was. All your, like, finished emotions, you used up Sunday because you, Lord knows what you got into Sunday night. So anyway, we'll talk about David and his racing a little bit. Let's talk about the race. Let's talk about the track. Let's talk about the race. Let's talk about all that stuff. Tell me about the track. What changes did they make?
Well, surface was same as warm-up. I think maybe it got a bit greasier because there were more cars on it, more running, hotter weather. So it started off really high bite, then the grip went down a bit because of all the oil from the exhaust on the track. And also, yeah, the line became really black from rubber. So after your run, you had your car was sort of oily and there was some rubber on it. That's all. And you just blew it off. So, really? I mean, I guess the best thing about tracks like that really is everything stays so clean.
Yes.
Yeah, that's the best thing. But yeah, even though the traction was lower, it was still definitely a high grip track. So
now
they changed the layout a bit. I like this layout more, to be honest. I preferred this over the warm up layout. Definitely, it flowed better. It was more fun to drive.
We should probably bring up IBC and see what the old layout looks like, and then go from there. But I thought that we had a glue track like this down in her in the DR at one point, and I knew once it got enough rubber and oil on it that traction goes away, because this actually has too much traction. Like, it's really edgy, hard. Like, when it's new, like, I don't know, because yeah, it was probably fresh too because they put a fresh layer on. But when that stuff's new, it's like, it's like flypaper. That's the best way I could describe it. Like, it's just sticky. You need hard tires. You need all, you know, you need, I used to run hard city blocks, like when the track was fresher, because that would give me some slide. And, you know, by the time the track kind of broke in a little bit, and had some rubber and had some oil on it, it just gives enough give, you know what I mean? And then this track had no dust on it, so no pieces were. I saw one little piece was breaking up, but it didn't get no dust. Like, we used to get dust that they want to track her, so that made it a little bit difficult. But yeah, man, I really like the section that I know it looks like it. I think I only saw one person try to do it. When you come off the straightaway and make that right corner and you make that, like, you just looks like you could send it and land it on the triple. But did anybody actually land a double there? or attempt it. You know, like if you come off the straightaway, make the left.
Some people doubled it, not onto the flat, but sort of almost. So you, I would call it a double roller. But it, I mean, it was risky and not really, didn't seem fast. It was definitely a way to overtake someone because you would be faster in that moment and get ahead of them. But no, it wasn't really used. Pretty much everyone just singled that jump.
It was a hard track to overtake, too. Bruno had the best overtake in the main. I think he jumped right past Canas early on, like in the back right left section there. That looked really good. Like Canas kind of came up short and Bruno just went pew and went past him. All right. So you like the track a lot better than the warm-up. You like the flow better. What was your favorite part of the track?
My favorite part of the track was, so after that section we talked about, after the straight, single, double, then you have that corner up there, and then you come down and you had a, whatever it was it like a double table, double right into the triple, and then land and drive into the chicane, like that section, that whole thing was really fun. I like that.
It looked like a lot of timing, too, especially in that double, like almost like what we had at RCGP in USA in Thunder Alley, but coming towards you.
Yeah, a lot of time. I like those kind of sections. And really good drivers really can make a difference there. We should ask David if he used brake. It sort of looked like he did, but driving too fast into the face and just using the brake to slow the car down a bit so it doesn't jump too far. And being really fast between the jumps. We should ask him.
We should. I think one of the hardest sections looked to be just after that, if you went up to that like hip where that go-kart wheel was, like that almost like a 180 right back, but it was a little just a bit off. You know what I'm talking about? I saw a lot of people get stuck up there or just get the edge of their car, roll up the new road on the jump, or they would just come off that jump because it was like a drop down like that, where Bruno made his mistake and where David got by him. Right there, that section seemed to cause a lot of people difficulty because it's hard to see. You couldn't see because the go-kart, for me, you couldn't see from the camera angle. I don't know how it was in the rostrum. But just looked like it caused a lot of people issues. I really like the back section going up the back there and coming back and coming onto the chicane, coming onto the straightaway. I think that was probably one of my favorite sections as well. It made for them guys coming through that chicane where Yuna passed Parente. We'll talk about that later as well. That was really nice. I thought, man, look, you know what? I thought that we knew that the facility was going to be beautiful. We knew that the track was going to be like this. We had a lot of people complaining during the semis on YouTube saying, oh, this racing's boring. I was trying to say, look, dude, you guys understand these guys are just trying to make it into the lanes. They know one mistake because that's what it was all about, mistakes. This track was so fast. If you made one little bobble, you was off so much. You know what I mean? And so these guys had to, like, that was probably one of the hardest things to do. Like, I saw now, I'm not going to lie, I was getting nervous about Ronnefalk. I mean, he wasn't TQing any runs. I didn't see him come second. What was his high? Like a fourth out of the qualifying?
Yeah, but, I mean, he had TQ in his grasp, but crashed.
Made mistakes.
One time in each of those, his best runs. So I wasn't worried about the qualifying result at all because I knew his pace was good. And
right,
the mistakes,
I
feel that the mistakes were just because in qualifying, you don't really see the other cars. You don't know the pace. So you push a bit extra. And I think that's what happened. And also the way his car is, or I would say his car, not just Mayako with a stock setup, is when he drives a bit more calm and he's a bit more patient, he actually goes faster.
You did
so in qualifying it. Yeah, so in qualifying it's I would say that he's more mistake prone in qualifying. So being that good, I was still confident going into the mains that it would be good because the lap time was there. Consistent,
right,
fast laps. The pace was good. That's really the only thing that I cared about at that point.
Yeah, I get that. I understand that. But let's talk about qualifying, because qualifying was actually very interesting. We had, was it Canas that took TQ1? Was it Coelho 2, Borac 3 and 4, and then Canas 5 again, I believe? Yeah, I think that's how it went.
Yeah, it was. The qualifying was actually good because it was so spread out. So going into the last day, I mean,
we didn't know
how many
were
there. Like 4-5 guys, maybe could take you.
Yeah,
and even the last round was still Burak and Canas, I think.
Yeah, Boots actually got
maybe
in between
Coelho
them.
Even.
Yeah, Boots got in between them. So like, if Burak would have finished second for that round, he would have TQ'd overall. But then Boots finished second in Q5. And yeah, then that just put Borac in second. But great driving by Borac, man. It's such a shame that he didn't make the final. But, man, he couldn't get no fuel. That seemed to be another big thing of this race, was fuel mileage, man. Guys are struggling. Well, other not the Viking, but is that the 16%? Guys are still struggling to get used to that?
Maybe. I don't really know, because I didn't have an issue either. Like, my run time was 9:20 or something. So when some people are like having really issues, I don't really know why. I didn't think it was especially sort of, it wasn't especially bad for fuel consumption, I thought. But
yeah, but when you have Borac and Yuna making two stops in a 15-minute LCQ, like, what's going on there?
Crazy.
And then Canas, what was he pitting at, 6 minutes? 6.5 or something?
Whatever the shortest stop from 7:30s, yeah, 6:47 something.
Yeah, so these guys, like some people were getting great mileage and some people other. What I think it's the fuel, man. I do. It has to be.
Maybe
people haven't figured it out yet. It don't sound like you're probably trying to let people know in on that secret either.
I mean, I ran a 9 mil Venturi, and
right.
Yeah, I wasn't trying to do anything to save fuel. I was just trying to get more power.
Yeah, but you don't drive wide open either.
Well, I mean, I don't
you're
know,
more of a mid-range
enough, I guess.
Yeah, I don't know, it just seemed weird. People shouldn't be pitting twice in a 50-minute final. One pit stop, that's all you need.
Yeah.
All right, so tell me about your race. Tell me what's going on when you get there. How you guys excited? Tell me about that. Who is fast? Who you know, first Euros in a long time. You don't seem, you know, stop focusing what's on there.
Let's same guys who I thought would be fast were fast, basically. That the surprise for me was Burak. I mean, we knew he was going to be fast, but the fact that he could put together 5 minute runs, that was the surprise for me. So I thought that I thought that he would be fast but make mistakes, but no,
right?
So he was TQing rounds; he was right up there. And I would say maybe Coelho was a bit better than expected. Also,
I expected
him to be good, but only sort of towards the end of the event, you know, semi-final, settle in main, strong main. That's what I expected. But he was like really on it from the beginning. That was a bit surprising, because this was the third Euros in 3 weeks for him. Touring car, 10 scale off-road, and now 8 scale off-road. So just that, the fact that, of course, his preparation can't be as good because he just did two other Euros that he also must have prepared somewhat for. So that's why I expected that. But yeah, he was better than expected, I would say. And maybe the one guy who I expected more from was actually Berton, because he was so good at the warm-up.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought he would do better. He did steadily improve, but he sort of never quite got there. So
yeah. Ongaro was like a note, like there, but not there. You know what I mean?
Yeah, so I think in the main he
flamed out or something.
Yeah, he did flame out, but he was already sort of a bit out of it. The top three pulled away and he was fourth. And that was a bit surprising to see. I think maybe his his tire choice, his tires, double down, whatever he ran, because one thing that did happen was that drivers, the hot race drivers, started using softer compounds. So they, I mean, early on in the week, they were like mediums, then hards, and going between medium and hard. And then they, towards the end of the race, then mains, last qualifying rounds, mains, they started running soft. And that's kind of where I think Ongaro had issues. So maybe the tire wasn't quite as competitive at that point when the track changed to where hot race guys were running soft compound.
I was shocked that guys were running soft because I was thinking that maybe the sidewalls would be too soft. But I guess with the greasy surface, yeah, that allowed for it. Right. Yeah, yeah. Interesting. But, you know, I thought like, oh, yeah, he's starting fourth. Like, Ongaro would be Ongaro. He'll be up there. But just nothing. Nothing from the beginning. Nothing at all. So it was very rare to see as well. Kanas, unbelievably fast, as we all said he would be.
One thing. Okay. I don't know if you remember, but when that Associated came out, I said that I think Ongaro will struggle. But he sort of fooled us all because it looked like he wasn't struggling, right? So then I thought, okay, well, that's impressive. Like, I was quite sure that the changes Associated made to the car made it sort of naturally slower, okay? More safe, better for most people. But for Ongaro and the benefits he had of the Associated, they reduced them with what they changed, narrow pivots, longer rear arms, all the changes they made, basically. So I thought he'll struggle. This race and the World's Warm-Up, even though he ended up winning the World's Warm-Up, I mean, World's Warm-Up in Redovan, he was sort of struggling until then eventually he won the race, right? Now he was struggling until he also struggled in the main. So maybe we are seeing some signs of what I predicted now that we are on these European style sort of higher grip, medium to high grip tracks, fast, you need corner speed. Now we are maybe seeing some issues for him.
What I am seeing though is that this type of track is allowing for a faster, more aggressive driving style from these younger guys like Burak and Berkan and Kanas. I'll throw Kanas in there because the way they're driving, like I was watching Burak, like I was just like, whoa, like, you know, it's like right on the edge of control. You're too close to the headset. You know, he was like when you say you're on the ragged edge, he was on ragged edge, you know, and my thing was like, can he keep that up for 45 minutes? But I think this surface and Kanas as well, man. Kanas super punch, like, you know, him and Figueiredo, even though this is his home track, like he's super punched. Like I watched him at DNC. So I think the driving style that a lot of these younger guys, well, Fiao isn't young, but you know, these like really fast, whippy, like whipping it all over the place and all that type of stuff. Like this new style of driving. I'm not saying new, but it's getting more fast. And this type of track is like the perfect track for it. So it was making me nervous, to be honest. Like I was like, wow, these kids, like they're fast. Well, these young guys are super fast. And on this track, they're like very hard to catch. I mean, you saw that first.
I think some people wrote that on the Discord too. About like, oh, they think that Burak and Robert, I mean, he did his 32s there at one point, and whoever they picked, I was like, there's no way, because they are too much on the edge. Like, no, everyone is human, right? You cannot do that for 45 minutes. You just can't, because you can't maintain that kind of extreme level of being on the edge without making mistakes for 45 minutes. Your tires, your car, your engines, your servers, like everything can't fucking handle it. Like you're going to, like your shock oil is going to heat up. Your defaults are going to heat up. Tires are going to heat up more than they would if you weren't so extreme. Then the car changes a bit. So you have to adapt while being on the ragged edge. track might change a bit. You're racing other cars. You have to get by back markers. Like, there is zero chance you can win a Euros on a track like that against this kind of competition with that style. You just can't.
Well, I agree with you. I agree with you. I said this. I said, you know, this is a new start. Like, it's so on the edge. But this is the type of track that they can get away with a lot of it, too, as well. But it's just, man, they're just a. I wanted Borac to be in there, but I didn't have him. I know, and it's no offense. I just, because of that, the way he drives, it was so on the edge. I didn't think he was going to make it. Now, Kanasnow was a different story. He's on the edge, but he's also learned to balance himself, I think. And we saw that at RCGP Italy. And obviously, I mean, he was fast right off the bat, her as well. I don't know what happened in the main, though. I mean, even before he ran out of, like, not ran out of fuel, even before he went in for his pit stop, Coelho was all on him, like crazy.
I mean, they were all just such a similar pace.
Right.
And the pit stops is what cycled him backwards, you know, because he had the shorter pit stop. So that was actually quite surprising that he couldn't do 7:30.
Maybe they were just counting on his driving skill to get so far. I think what they were maybe counting on was him to just pull away from everybody and his ability to drive through traffic and lap the field, you know? I don't know what they were thinking.
Played it safe, you know, like it was so close or something. I don't know, but I didn't think it would be.
Yeah, I mean, but how could you? It would have been impossible to win with that. Like, you know what I mean? With David and Coelho going much longer than you so much. Like three laps longer, four laps at some point.
Yeah, well, I guess they have something to work on.
Well, oh my God. Actually, you know what? Look how cocky you've gotten.
Well, no. It's the truth.
Something to work on.
Yeah, Reds. Everyone was kind of running that Kyosho air filter because it gives more power but less runtime. So yeah, there you go.
Right, everybody's searching for power. 16%, see? Everybody's searching for power. I don't know, dude. Hey, did you send a link to David?
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to go pay some bills and then I'm going to come back and we'll talk some more about this. All right?
Okay.
BeatRC.com, the racer's one-stop online hobby shop. Choose from all the popular brands and variety in stock with super fast shipping and great customer service. BeachRC.com still has the local hobby shop feel with all the benefits of the internet. BeachRC.com is the exclusive distributor for Ultimate Racing, JQ Racing, Pro Circuit Racing Tires, Nitro Lux Fuels, and Assault RC Performance Products. So fill up your cart and check out at BeachRC.com today.
Yes, check out BeachRC. Oh, no, we switched places. We have an affiliate link. If you guys can use that, we greatly appreciate it. As JQ, no, I got there. We go. I like being on to the left of you. So my right. No, actually.
This is right.
Anyway, so what are we gonna? Is David ready? Is he here?
I mean, he's not here, but he has the
okay. All right. Well, let him know whenever he's ready, he can come on. So anyway, JQ, tell me. So let's talk about some more stuff. How about who shocked you, by the way? Who surprised you? Know who surprised me? Matthias. Matthias is damn fast. Wow.
Yeah.
That dude could have made the main almost, dude.
Yeah, and he's retired.
That's insane. You know what? I don't want to keep the Viking up. We don't keep champions up late, so we're gonna do something real quick and bring him in. He'll be here in a second. But yeah. We'll be right back. Yo, thank you. That, in case you guys didn't know, that was an Invisible Speed commercial, but it has no spoken word. So it looks good on YouTube, but it has no spoken word. What's up, Viking?
For the podcast.
Three times. Congratulations, dude.
Thank you.
Hey, long time coming for you. I know your last one since 2014. Congratulations. I was so nervous. Oh. Oh man, don't ever do that to me again, please. You know, let's be fast right from the get-go. Let's TQ runs. Yeah. Let's get all that going. But no, you know what? I'd rather you not have any TQ runs and just be, you know, save it all for the final day. What a brilliant drive, dude. I was so nervous. Congratulations.
Thank you. Yeah, it was definitely great final today for me. Made mistakes a couple of times throughout qualifying and didn't really get the clean runs needed to challenge for the TQ. But, you know, even with the mistakes, I was still, you know, within top six. I finished six after qualifying. So I felt that, like, making those kind of mistakes that I did and still being towards the front, I'd say, after qualifying, made me feel very comfortable anyway, because I knew that, if I would just put it together, you know, the speed was definitely there to get the victory. So that was like all the focus was for that on Saturday, just to keep the driving clean. And that's what I did, and probably drove the main of my life in that one.
Yeah, I saw that in your race report. What made this so much different from the other races, this main?
Even at our level, I wouldn't say that there's a lot of races that you or lots of mains that you finish without having one marshal, I would say. And especially on that kind of a track, which was so intense with the high grip and high speed. The layout was kind of, it was pretty long, I'd say, but the lap times were quick because of the grip and the smoothness of the track, I'd say. Very good flowing jumps, quick jumps. So it was a very fast pace around it. And you really had to focus very hard to be able to stay clean on that kind of a track. Because as soon as you just go offline a little bit, the grip level changes. Actually, like, it was more grip outside of the line towards the end of a race, because in the line it was kind of a greasy, slimy feeling. Even though that in the main, when the temperature dropped, grip picked up as well in the line because of the cooler conditions. But yeah, we just, you know, you had to be in line to keep it consistent. And as soon as you went out of the line, the car could do, it could do like a go up on two wheels, or if you like touch the pipe or whatever, you can be flying off the track. So definitely a challenging track, challenging conditions, but the car and the package, everything worked really, really well throughout the whole event. We had a good view on what we're going to start with after the warm-up. Spent a day of testing there after that race, and found some good stuff there on Monday. So basically that's where we started the race with. Just had a couple of tweaks on that kind of setup from France, because I went to France 2 days before the Euros to practice with Adrien on a track which was kind of, I wouldn't say it's close to being the same, but it was as close as you can get to that track in Barcelos, because the track I went to in France was very smooth and it was good grip. You had a lot of tire wear and stuff on that track. So all that was different from the track in Portugal, because in Portugal there was like no tire wear whatsoever. So we found some things there that I felt really good with, comfortable with driving. And as I said, we spent two full days there. So I got a lot of track time with the car, pretty much like we ran it at the Euros. So I knew it very well and it felt very comfortable from free practice and on, I would say. So we could just focus on making smaller tweaks to the setup during the event at the Euros, which was a benefit in many ways, because like, I'd say it's the first race in this year in a long time that I was very relaxed throughout the whole week, because you know there was lots more time in between runs, so you didn't have panic to change the car. Or at some of the races we've been to, like the warm up, or even RCGP's kind of tight schedule with the low entry that we had in Italy. So then you don't have much time to change stuff, you know. And especially, I mean, this track, the car doesn't get dirty either. So now you get more time. Instead of cleaning the car, you can focus on changing the stuff you want. And then we had like 2 hours or so in between the runs. So definitely more time and less stressful. So I think that was also great, because like I felt like at the other races, or a couple of the last races I've been to, I've been very, you know, stressed on getting the car ready for the next run, basically. And then you're not really focused mentally. And I think that's the mental part is such a big part of racing today, because the level of your competitors is so high. So you can't afford making the mistakes that you could, I would say, 10 years ago or so, because instead of having one guy to fight, you have another four or five guys you have to beat that day. So the focus and the mental side of the racing is big today. And I think I was definitely there mentally this week. Like I said, was very comfortable from the get-go, and we could just kind of build on the setup that we had coming there that worked really well, and just tweaked it ever so slightly throughout the week. And like I said, the tire choice with the hot race as well, Sahara tire there worked really well. And I drove them for, I think I had Bangkok's the first two practices, which was the tire I ran at the warm-up for a fair bit. But Sahara was definitely a faster tire. And at the warm-up, I struggled a little bit with the Sahara because they had too much bite, especially side bite. But you could clearly see that we found a good balance in the car, because when we put the Sahara on, it was just quicker without being more difficult to drive. So that gave me the speed, like the lap times I needed. And then, like I said, it was still easy to drive. So I could do it comfortably in the runs we made. So yeah, super pumped about that one, of course. And I'm really happy I was able to pull that drive out in the main, that I mean, when it was needed the most. Semi-final was good. I didn't make any big mistake. I think I had one smaller one. Don't remember if I needed a marshal in that one, but you know, I it was good. Like now afterwards, it was great that I was able to get by Davide there when he crashed towards the end of the semi, because he was clearly missing some pace in the start of the main. So starting in front of him was really key to be able to get to be able to follow Bruno and Canas out of the gate, because they were very quick in the start. I felt like they might have had a upper hand on me pace wise in the first five minutes or so, but I hung in there, and as they were making maybe some smaller mistakes or so, I didn't rush. I just kept focusing on my lines, and everything came together very nicely there after a couple of first 5-10 minutes or so, and I was able to close in. And as well with my pit strategy being having one less stop than Canas was definitely big as well. So then I knew as long as I didn't make any mistake, I would be on his back door, let's say. I had that advantage over him, and was kind of racing Bruno from that point. And and he had two mistakes in the main that kind of put in the 10-12 second back, or whatever it was in the end. But yeah, it was a very close race for the first 25 minutes or so. But once I got that kind of a gap in the pit stop over Canas, and then Bruno when he had those two mistakes, you know, I wasn't gonna let that slip out of my hands this time. So my focus was very sharp. I'm sure, like, if you talk to Adrien, I mean, in the last couple of races, yeah, I could say something during the main, but I don't think I said much to Adrien this time. I was just, you know, focusing and kind of just listened to whatever he said or whenever I needed to come into pit or something like that. But I never talked about anything. I said, like, coming up the hill on the last lap, I said, like, something like, this is ours or something like that. And we crossed the line and we were able to get that third title after 8 years without anything in the Nitro class. So that was awesome.
Oh man, yeah, I was so happy. I kind of think I watched it. I would summarize exactly like I thought you was just kind of hanging behind them because there's no real pressure behind you for a while, for a long time, and you're just in third, just behind them. And I was like, either he's waiting for a mistake or from them where they both catch each other and he can go by, or he's just waiting for everything to kind of kick in and get in the flow. And you got a great start. You know, you got a good start. You didn't get in any trouble. I don't think you could ask more about, you know, obviously the only better one would be to start out first. But what I said was really important, that you couldn't let those two guys kind of get away from you and get back. Yeah. If you were to, because that's been one of your biggest issues. Like, you got a bad start, you fall all the way back, then you got to fight all the way through the pack, and you know, by the time you get there, you've used your tires, used everything. So you got the proper start, you was comfortable, and then of course, like Degani was on the other line. As I look, he's like, he's got it. It's like 10 minutes ago. It's like, dude, the luck that this guy has, no way. Like, I'm seeing this guy's lost receivers. You know, I was like, it ain't over until it's over. But yeah. Man, it was just, I know for you, it was a big relief as well. I can imagine a lot of pressure you've put on yourself, a lot of pressure. You know, you're carrying a two brand new brands on your back. That's a lot of weight. So this is, and look, everybody has you as winning this race, but let's be honest, this isn't your favorite type of surface. You know, you like a little bit loose and like DNC.
Yeah.
This is a C hub. I mean, a pillow ball type track as well. It's, you know, so it's like, Canass on great form, Bull Rock surprising form, you know, well, not surprising, but on really fast at this race, and Coelho really fast too. But man, you beat them. Like, you beat everybody, and you did it in a convincing manner. Like, not even, there's like, nobody can say anything. Like, you just beat them badly. Like, it wasn't no, they didn't, like, okay, when Coelho made that mistake, I was like, all right, you got him. That was it. Yeah. I was like, you got him. And that would be that was the end of Coelho right there. But man, great run.
It's like a great boost as well, being able to beat those guys, you know, straight up without them having any issues. Is like, it's one thing if you win because of, you know, like Davide had a flame out and, you know, something would have happened to Bruno. That's one thing. But, you know, to beat like Bruno and Canas when they are as good as they are right now, that's definitely a boost for me, you know, mentally for that part of the racing as well. And especially going into the Worlds, like having beat those guys on this kind of a track, just, 2 months before the big event in September, is definitely a good feeling coming into the Worlds.
Oh yeah, definitely a confidence booster. And you're going to a track that you like and that you like more, and that hopefully, well, if they don't, we don't know what it's going to be like, and that hopefully that the car is really good at. And it's good to hear that you was comfortable, because I remember seeing you at RCGP, and I remember you saying this, that even at the first one, it's such a quick turnaround to get things done, and you got to try and get on pace. But here was a little bit more laid back. We want to know, what was your favorite part of the track?
I definitely prefer this layout over the warm up, I'd say. I think it was a faster pace on this one. Still challenging though. Had a couple of technical sections, but it was more like you needed to time the jumps very well. I mean, to be able to go quick. On the other one, my least favorite section of the warm-up layout was the back right section, where you had that tight chicane and then you came up into like section of some steps, like first step down and then step up and then step down, which was kind of a couple of rollers. So I never felt really comfortable. I didn't get the car to work really well in those sections at the warm-up during the race. I mean, like I said, we found some stuff on Monday there after warm-up, so definitely felt better. So maybe it would have been different coming back on that same layout with a car that I feel comfortable with. But I was happy to see them change that kind of a section because it was definitely not my favorite at the warm-up. And, you know, now I just think it suited me, the layout like it was suited me very well, and it was pretty clear. I could definitely feel in the main which kind of part on the track I was a little faster, and then like Bruno and Canas would have the upper hand on a couple of other sections. So I felt like in the tight infield where you had that small double coming into the left hand and then big double in the corner there, maybe they were a little quicker over those jumps in the middle part of the track. But then like I felt like coming up the hill and all the left side, the switchback before the straight, I liked that section a lot and drove really well there in the final. And I felt like that was like the part mm-hmm. of the track where I felt like I was a little quicker than them. So like dropping down from that left-hand 90 degree up on the left side of the track. So, but you know, overall, it was just like such a great track, which held up, I mean, perfectly, obviously with the glue they had. We did see like two or three jump faces break up a little bit in the main, actually. So I had to change up the line a bit on the jump section after the straight. So after you went up that 180 with the hill and then came back towards you, that's where the track, one of the jump faces in that section broke up a bit. So almost rolled it there coming out of the pit one time in the main. And, you know, I hit that once, and then I was right away, I was like, okay, either inside or outside on that one, because otherwise I'm going to, you know, flip over. Yeah, I mean, just a perfect display. Track was amazing. Everything around it was great. And huge props to the Figueiredo family for, the whole event was ran super, super smooth and everything. I've seen some of the reports said that the security might have been a little bit over the top, and yeah, I can agree with that. But you know, they put on a great show, and just like the banners of all the previous winners of IFMARS and the European Championship was cool to see, and like, yeah, everything was just awesome. I mean, you can really see that they put their heart into it to be able to probably get something even bigger in the future. Yeah, for sure. It's not great. The last time we'll be going to Portugal.
I heard that next year will be Worlds for 8-scale electric, and that it would be there.
Yeah,
that'd be great.
But before this, I hadn't even heard that we would have Worlds in 8-scale electric. So
yeah, I haven't either. But
that's what I heard. So let's see.
Yeah, I think it's awesome. Like when they do paint the infield like they do as well, it just looks amazing on the pictures, and I'm sure on the video and everything as well. Just next level, everything there.
So let's say you are now a fan of the glue track.
I mean, with the Mayako, yeah.
Oh, and but it also looks good too. It does look really good.
Yeah,
it looks. I thought I just sat when I was sitting there. I was just like, man, I wish I was there. That's all I kept saying. I was like, man, I wish I was there. It looks so great. How was it? Was it really hot? There was it hotter than Italy?
I think it was similar to Italy, maybe a little bit more of a breeze. So it was actually some kind of small wind. In Italy, it was just, you know, zero nothing. Wind and very hot, like a sauna.
By the way, man,
let's talk about the fuel. Oh, sorry. Go ahead, JK.
I have to correct you. You are talking about how it's a pillow ball track. As the Mayako race engineer and designer, I have to say that we have pillow ball substitute.
And it's
next
what
level
I use.
Pillow ball. Yeah. And even David used that. Amazing. So geometry like or similar to pillow ball. So you get the benefits of the pillow ball without having balls. So there you go.
Or you can be juggling two balls instead of three. That's what you were saying. That's what it comes down to, engine tuning.
That's for engines.
Who surprised you, David? Who was fast that you wasn't expecting to be so fast?
Well, I mean, Burak and those guys has been, they have been fast this year, but they haven't really been that fast, I'd say. Mm-hmm. I think Pro Circuit came with a new tire for this event, which looked like it worked really well for them, and especially when the track was like in the mornings, when in the cooler conditions, when it was very, very grippy. That's when they really they were really fast, Burak and Berkan, and like Q4 was the one he TQ'd on the last day of qualifying, very quick run, and it seemed like those, yeah, he was just able to push the car really hard in the very, very grippy conditions in the cool in the cooler temperatures. So would have been interesting to of course have him in the main as well, but he was running very consistent. Like usually he pushes so hard that there's a like a couple of mistakes that you know, that happens once in a while for him, but it was great to see him doing so well. For sure he will be one to count for the future races, I'm sure.
Yeah, man, Ongaro surprisingly not in the show, not even really showing. You know, we always think that Ongaro is going to do what Ongaro does in the main, but I mean, he did flame out, but just he never really showed up this weekend. So Joseph and I were just talking about that. Maybe it's a track in the grip level and whatnot.
I think like I never seen Davide make so many mistakes. Like we were talking about that with Joseph as well, and like throughout all the rounds of qualifying. I mean, usually he's very, very steady, keeps clicking off laps, and this time he was actually making mistakes. So I don't know if that was due to pressure, not feeling 100%, you know, comfortable with the car and everything on the track, or he felt like he needed to push to go in that, you know, same speed or whatever it was, but he was making more mistakes than he usually does.
There's pressure on him now, a lot more pressure. Canas is fast. Yep. Now you win. So now he's got more pressure on him, much more pressure. Let's talk about your fuel mileage, new engine. You got, like Adrien said, you guys could have went longer. You didn't want to risk it. Since at DNC, he was on a very long fuel mileage as well.
Yeah.
So you guys have definitely figured out something there with the course attack. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
The engines are manufactured in Italy and completely new case and everything in the engine for us. Obviously with Adrien's experience throughout the years, he knows what stuff he wanted to do with the Corsatec brand of engines, and it's been working really well for us so far. And this time you could even see logo and stuff on the head, so it's not that far out. Everything is being finalized now here during these couple of weeks here in the summer, and should be available pretty soon. But yeah, we have had great performance in terms of speed. Definitely, like a lot of you saw, that we had good mileage as well, good runtime on the engines, that's on the level that we are now. Even the mistakes Bruno didn't cost him more like than 5 seconds or so. Like if you can save one pit stop, it's five mm-hmm. seconds, 6 seconds. It's definitely big. Not just that you save those 5-6 seconds, but mentally it's very important as well. Like as soon as you see someone going, you know, an extra stop, it gives you some breathing room, let's say, and it can be frustrating for the guy going short, so that can end up with him crashing as he thinks or wants to push harder to make up time for that extra pit. So it was definitely big being able to go 7:30, and like Adrien said in the interview, we had I think we had like 9:55, or it was very close to 10 minutes runtime. So with the track being 33 seconds like long, it's a shorter kind of a track, and then if you have 9:50, I mean, there is space to go for a 9-minute pit stop. But I usually, I mean, we in the past, we've done like a gamble one or two times, and both times we failed because of the, in the main, it seems like everything is always, it's always taking a bit of more fuel. So I'm not a huge fan of making a gamble on that kind of stuff before before I'm sure that it will be fine. So I like always like to have more than a minute on a kind of 30-35 second track. So I said, like, you know, I doubt that anyone else is able to go 9. I think like 7:30, yeah, some can do it, but I don't think everyone will be going 7:30. That's what I said to Adrien before. So let's do 7:30, and then I can just, you know, I don't even have to think about saving fuel or being smooth on the trigger. I can just, you know, focus and drive like I want to in the main. And that's what we went for in the end. And you know, it worked out very well for us. And as well, I have to say, like, you know, JQ, he pit me at warm-up, at the world's warm-up. It was good. But having Adrien and Pierre back in the pits, it was I definitely didn't lose seconds in the pit. So I think they had some of the faster pit stops this time. You can't afford losing an extra second. If you pit 6 times in a main, that's 6 seconds you lose if you're a second off every time. So
that's correct.
Like, the dream team was back, and they delivered.
Yeah, Pops looked like he was super, super happy about it as well, to have you back up there. I know it's 8 years is a long time, but now you're up in who? So who else has 3? Robert has 3.
Reno, who else has 3?
Reno got 3 in a row though, right?
Yeah, and I think Danny Record probably.
Maybe Daniel Record,
four.
Yeah.
I think he has 4.
Yeah, maybe he has 4. I'm not sure. 3 or 4.
Wow, and you know what? Hampus done well too, I have to say. Hampus just missed making, I shouldn't say just missed it, but Hampus will be in the semi. Hampus can make, I think, one more year, and Hampus can be, he'd be knocking on the door of these finals, I think.
Yeah, because, it looks like this year he's been doing really well with the Mayako as well. I think the car suits him very well. And like you said, it was very close of making it to the main this time. He had a couple of mistakes and some struggle with the, I think it was the servo in the semi there, and losing the brakes. On this kind of a track, you can't afford losing the brakes. Not easy, easy for him in that one, but he should be proud. I think 19th is very good. The competition is high, and he shows that he's almost there. So we'll see. Maybe already at the Worlds he can, you know, make another great result and build on that. But he's been doing great so far this year, even at the RCGP, like you said.
Yeah, he is in a pool of a lot of fast young guys as well.
Yeah,
a lot of fast young guys.
Yeah, so David, what I think is good with them is like they've been racing international for a very long time. Like here in Europe, they've been going to many of the races that I have been to as well. And you know, that's how you get faster. I'd say, like, he can race as much as he wants here in Sweden and win all the races here. But like, as soon as he go out of Sweden and have to face those other fast guys from all the countries, that's when you can take your racing to the next level and become a more consistent, and also get better speed is when you face the other fast guys from other countries.
Yes, he's doing very well. I'm super impressed with Hampus, JQ's little brother. Man, I'm so happy for you, so relieved. I know, happy for JQ. We actually have a video of JQ on your final lap, you know, and he hasn't shown this to you yet.
I think Lee said that he had a video.
I didn't know
they were filming.
And we're gonna see JQ, the emotionalist green haired man child, showing emotion to some extent. This is Finnish emotion, I guess.
Didn't know he had emotions.
Oh, he has emotions. When he has, how many Vodka and Red Bulls had you had by this time, JQ?
Let's say quite five.
Five. There we go.
One more is all you open. Oh my god. That's left. My retirement present is so close. Where's Coelho? Nah, he made it through.
He won't.
Oh, none of them won now.
Time.
Where's David?
Finish now.
He's done it.
Oh, yes!
Yeah.
Oh.
That's good.
Well done.
Well done.
Congratulations. 2 decades.
Yeah, a lot of hard work went into that, dude. Thank you, David. He said, he goes, do you know what my pulse rate was? Guess what my pulse rate was?
Oh, yeah.
I was like, I don't know, 180, because mine was going about 180. 132, and I was just sitting there. Well, you had about 5 vodka and Red Bulls too. That might have happened. But yeah, man, that's a lot. I think what people don't understand is the amount of work that went into get into that. And yeah, you won that race for a lot of people. A lot of people that's been around, been there, been through. And thank you. So Worlds. Yeah, we're feeling great for Worlds. I like that. Confidence. Confidence, and yeah, this is just what you needed, like just what you needed. Now we go RCGP. That's going to be a completely different type of track. You get to race Canas and these guys again. Let's beat them there. Then you get even more confidence, and then we just win the Worlds. Like, that's all.
Yeah,
easy. That's it. Like, just win it. Like, you know, just win the Worlds against everybody. You've done it before.
Yeah.
No, man. Super happy for you. I know. Like. Just like the amount of pressure coming off JQ too, super pumped. I'm happy. Like, I'm super pumped about this, and just a great drive, man. You put on a clinic, like, and I think everybody, like, you can see, like, how many people, like, commented and just sent you some, just people are happy for you. So that's good to see too, Yeah. So congratulations. We appreciate it. Thank you for coming on. Hold on. Shoot. Oh, I almost forgot. Something else great happened while we was at the Euros. Mission accomplished. JQ retired.
Yeah. I forgot.
Yeah, he's retired. Let's put that in quotes.
Yeah.
So his nemesis beat him. How many places did she beat you by?
I mean, right ahead of me.
She flamed on the line. Like, she flamed rolling over the line, and Joseph was right behind her.
Well, do you know what?
We coasted over together.
Get any closer than that, but she still beat you.
Yes, I put my green retirement shirt on before the main. I bumped from the eighth final. Then I changed my shirt for that quarterfinal. I even told her before the race. Like, I already changed. I'm ready.
Yeah, Jessica Paulson retired. JQ. Well, I'm sure he's already found a loophole to run the Worlds. He's going to run it as a hobbyist.
She even said something about that in the report. You can be her, whatever, little helper.
Ah, there you go, JQ. She needs some invisible speed.
Yeah, she will need that.
Great job. Great job, David. I know it's late. I'm going to let you go. We'll be talking later. See you in the UK. And man, congratulations, man. Let's become a 2-time world champion.
I'm working on some world stuff right now.
Yeah, I noticed. We can see it in your glasses. No many joking. Be panicked. All right, David. Thank you, man. Hey, congratulations. And thank you. Good job, man. Thank you.
Thank you.
3-time European champion and lots more to go.
No, I'm 8-time. 3-time in Nitro.
Okay. 3-time in the glory. Jeez, 8-time. And how old are you again? 26?
26, yeah.
3-time in the glory. That didn't sound right. So you got plenty of time to win more. There we go.
Yeah.
All right, my friend. Thank you for everything, and you have a good evening. Get, you know, enjoy victory time.
All right. See ya. See you guys.
Bye-bye.
Right. Bye-bye. JQ, I'm not finished with you. We still got a way to go. We got some ranting to do. We got some stuff to talk about.
What's the rant today?
Oh, we're going to talk about driving penalties and all that good stuff. Yeah, penalties. But we got to pay some bills first.
Wait, isn't there something else to rant about?
I don't know. You sent me pictures and like, we need to talk about this, but I have no idea what you're talking about. But I just wanted to get your closing thoughts on the Euros. And you sent me a picture of somebody dumping fuel or something.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Something like that.
That was so funny. Maybe another day.
Yeah, maybe another day. Maybe another day. Let's pay some bills.
Techno RC. Techno RC is a premium manufacturer specializing in 8th and 10th scale high-performance off-road RC buggies and trucks. Visit www.technorc.com for a complete catalog of their products. Techno RC. Excellence in engineering. Hashtag Techno Takeover.
Yes, thank you to Techno RC for their continued support. A lot of the Techno guys are going up to Divisions Racer this weekend.
I can't believe Techno's still sponsoring your podcast.
I'm super happy that they're still sponsoring the podcast. Thanks, no thanks to you being rude. But
I've been rude in a very long time.
And keep it that way. Keep it that way. Also, this podcast is brought to you by TNR Fuels. We're at the NNRC. We're all about the glory, and that glory is Nitro. TNR Fuels is the hottest nitro fuel in the market, owned and operated by Chris Nelson and his family. Made by racers for racers. TNR Fuels is currently available throughout the USA, and I believe he is now internationally shipping. For more information, support the company, or get it in your local hobby shop, you can visit them at www.tnrfuels.com or contact Chris Nelson directly at chris@tnrfuels.com or find them on Facebook or House of RC. Thank you to TNR Fuels for all their support. I think they're going to be the world tour soon for on-road and off-road. So, JQ, let's talk about this retirement now. You know, the other important thing that happened.
Yeah.
Oh, I already know you and your bets. Well, so first, Greg messaged me and says, I said, what's this? JQ's retired. I said, yeah, he's retired. Jessica Paulson beat him. So now he's retired. He goes, he can't retire. We have a bet for the Worlds.
Yeah.
No, he has to unretire because I have to beat him at the Worlds.
Yeah, there's no way Degani beats me. I mean, Paulson, okay, yeah. She can beat me, but not Degani.
Yeah, but you're retired. So you're not seriously racing anymore. You're just racing to learn setup.
Yeah. And, I'll do the Worlds in my free time.
Right, right. We've established that that's your loophole. You're a hobbyist. Right now, yeah. I'm doing quotes with one finger because I want one set of hands because I can only do it with one set of hands. So you're a hobbyist now.
Yeah.
How does it feel to be retired?
It's good. It's been a long time coming, to be honest.
Have you finally accepted what I've been trying to beat through your head for the last 3 years? Or are we just saying this so I can shut up? Yeah, I knew it. You always find a way to vouch on your bets. I knew you would find some way. Now you're next. Look, I can hear it now.
Miguel Matias is retired.
Okay. Miguel Matias was good already.
Yeah, but he's also retired.
Yes, but he also almost won a Worlds. You have never.
Yeah, but he's also retired. But he was racing.
He's also better than you.
So you can still retire and race.
Yeah, but he doesn't go off the deep end or the cliff or have some, you know, he's not looking. We don't have to hide sharp objects and all rope from him when he does bad, like we have to do for you.
No, not anymore.
You say that every race.
I'm retired now. David,
no, you should have had your see, the thing is, you had your retirement shirt on, but you should have had your invisible speed shirt on when you went and got your cock. I mean, your rooster.
You mean this thing?
Yeah, I wonder what is that. So I wanted to know what's the big thing with the cocks. I mean, the roosters.
Some local thing. They had them in the town also, looking like this. Not with RC cars, but still.
So you won that for best manufacturer? Yeah, man.
I've been telling you for a fucking long time. Come on.
Okay, we can
focus,
see.
For fuck's sake.
We can see your Cox's feet.
There you go.
There we go. Number what a great logo car. That was, too. That was really cool. I thought that was so cool. Like, they had a logo for the track, and they had it up there on the...
Yeah.
I hope. Because it doesn't look positive for this Red of All for me, but the fucking... Maybe next year. All right, Joseph. So what you're basically saying is you're retired in theory, but not practically.
No, I retired. I'm going to the Swedish Nationals. I'm not racing. I'm helping on the Mayako drivers. I'm going to RCGP. We are hiring a driver, renting a driver, finding someone to race in my place.
Maybe what?
Hopefully Pekko.
We haven't even talked about that.
Schumacher driver, so he's free for chassis. He races for a hobby shop here, so hopefully he can run the Mayako there. I'll pit for him.
Okay.
So that's definitely retired in my book.
All right. Well, good. Let's talk about some of the other drivers that raced her. So,
I did try to retire early already, remember? And then Sankatin wasn't vaccinated and couldn't fly to America. So he ruined it.
Well, you have no excuse to unretire now.
Also, I'm making it official because I'm working on a video. I had it on the flight home. I was feeling all emotional. And I thought, you know what? Fuck it. I'll make this one video. Anyone who knows the real JQ product story in the beginning and our videos will know something about this video. They will know.
I wasn't there from the get-go.
It's going
to
be good.
You know what, though? Before we move on and talk about more other drivers, I just wanted to say, well done. And this is also, even though this isn't JQ Racing, this is for all the JQ drivers that have come through and had to eat a lot of shit, take a lot of shit because of you. But it finally paid off. I mean,
yeah,
the Euros is great.
It's crazy. It's crazy, but there are people from day one who are still now running Mayako, but I mean, it's the same.
Yeah, that's same for those soul, guys. That's for those guys. You know, all those guys that I met when I came on board 5 years ago. You know, that's loyalty right there. So
we had it here.
Yeah, exactly. If wouldn't have made it a revolt, this guy. What's that beeping noise? Is that you making a beeping noise?
No.
Like boop. Definitely sounds like you.
I'm not beeping.
Definitely sounds like you. All right, Jake, anything to add about the win before we go and talk about some other drivers and do some ranting?
No.
All right. You know what? I think we're going to pay some bills, and then we'll come back and we'll talk about some other drivers. High-Tech RCD is a leader in RC systems, delivering the highest performance and reliability, supported by a dedicated customer service personnel. The HSB 9381TH servers have efficient brushless motors, titanium gears, low consumption, constant output, and a metal case. They're also announcing their new DB778WPs, which are perfect for your 10-scale on- and off-road needs. Manufactured with high-tech's high-technology industrial servo innovation. Also, the RDX2 Pro Charger, which I have right here, can charge 2 battery packs at a time and provide power to your engine and tire warmer needs. Also, it has a nice USB. You can charge your phone, everything off of there. And it has a Bluetooth dongle that you can monitor your batteries off your phone, off their app. So trust in High-Tech, your server and charger headquarters. Visit hightechrcd.com/where-to-buy for your nearest dealer. Thank you, High-Tech, for all your support. Greatly appreciated. JQ. So, other drivers, man. What a great, I think fourth. If you would have told me Robert Battier would have came fourth at this race, I would have said no way. I think that's a great result for Robert. You know?
It is. I'm sure he wanted that, well, win, but podium at least. But fourth is still, I mean, look at the drivers there. Fourth is still really good.
Yeah. ended up being a top Mugen guy, even though like Burak was kind of out, but great run for him.
Oh, yeah, I didn't think about that. Top Mugen still.
Yeah. Juan Carlos Canas cut his foot in the swimming pool. Was his foot that bad? Did you see it?
Yeah. Yeah, apparently. I mean, it was all bandaged up. I didn't see it.
Wow. So he cut his foot open. Do you think that affected his driving any bit? Do you think it made it harder for him to drive? Okay. So you said you was impressive, Coelho. If this track would have been different, would Coelho have been faster this track had this been Redovan, you think? Or would it
Redovan?
Been? Yeah.
I think not quite, because it's bigger. It gets a bit rough. It gets dusty, inconsistent grip. It's harder. It's more off-roady. Mm-hmm. This is still like touring car, 10 scale on Astro or carpet, whatever. This track, it's close. Mm-hmm. Come on. There's no drifting. There's no bumps.
Yeah, I get what you mean.
I mean, there was more bumps on the 10 scale track.
Yeah, that's for sure. So, let's go through the main here. Ricardo Breton, like you said, fifth, kind of like was never nowhere in qualifying. I think he would probably won a podium. I think a top five for him is good, you know, because he never really was there all weekend, I would say. Would you agree there?
I mean, I expected more because he was so good at the warm-up.
Okay. Let's put it that way. All right. Barkan Jr., I think he also won top junior award, sixth. I mean, to be honest, I think Barkan will do better than that. Burak was faster than him all week. But I think Barkan can hold his head high going home for sixth. You know, I think next year definitely want to be looking to get up into that top three by next year. Or his brother definitely wants to be up there.
Yeah, I think it was a great result for him.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
I think he's a little bit gutted about his brother, but I mean, they're so close. I was talking to him on his way back. Daniel Parente, I have, you know, controversial that he's even in there, I think, but great run for him.
Right, because of the LCQ?
Yeah, we'll talk about that in a minute. But a great run for this young kid. Like, you know, good run, seventh.
His home track in Madrid is also high grip, so they have knowledge of these kind of surfaces. So I am I wouldn't say that I'm surprised, just pleased for him. I mean, he's a young kid, fast, good to make his first Euro main.
Yeah, I would say so. Boots, eighth, he would want better than that. But I, to be honest, I don't think Boots was fast in Q5. He likes that he found some speed in Q5.
Yeah, but he was already fast, I think, in Q4 or 3 or something, but he had a crash. Yeah, 4, I think, the last day. So he could have had like 2 really good runs on that day.
Right.
I don't know why he then wasn't as fast in the main anymore.
Man, Ongaro would be upset with ninth. I mean, he had a flame out, but he would win. He would want to. He'd be expecting to win this. When is this guy going to win a Euros, man?
Yeah, it's amazing he hasn't won a Euros in 8 scale. I mean, 10 scale, 2-wheel drive is one. Did he win an electric 8 scale? Maybe.
I think so.
But 8 scale Nitro, just can't get it done. And this time, he flames out, and he did post that his fuel tubing was cut. And he did make mention of that there was pre-tech. So somehow, like, due to
his blaming pre-tech.
Yeah, somehow due to pre-tech, his fuel line would have been cut. Accidentally. So that's what he did. He posted.
Do you think it's any truth to that? Possibly.
I don't know.
The fastest Finnish person, Pekko. So I think this is very impressive for Pekko. Him and Hattonen did the Euros last week in England and made the trip over her. And then he was telling me like how like just unprepared they were for this race, like, you know, and how the Finnish team banded around them to get them going. But I mean, Pekko finally shows like, I think this is like, I think, you know, Max loves him, you love him, but I think this shows his potential. Like if this kid could put some focus on maybe just doing one class and having proper support around him, he can win these races. You know what I mean? Maybe in another 2 years or so.
Yep, I would agree. He's really good. And actually, Jonas Carlo, they both ran associate, but Jonas car looked better than his, to be honest. But Jona made some mistakes also, unfortunately for Jona. His one run, which was a ninth place, he got disqualified because his fuel tank was too big.
Mm-hmm.
And then on the last day, he never got a good enough result. So he started in the quarterfinals, then he bumped and then didn't bump from the semis. But with that result, I mean, he would have been towards the top of the semifinal and it would have been a different story. Pekko was in the other semifinal, which was a bit slower. And yeah, he had a good run, clean run, and he made the main. So really good job for him, I would say.
Yeah, Yao Figueiredo in 11th. I mean, I knew Yao would be in the main. I didn't expect him. You know, I didn't expect him to win, even though this is his home track. He's good. He's punched and all that stuff, but I think these guys are fast.
Style thing that we spoke about. Against these drivers, this crowd, you cannot win on a track like that, driving like that. It's not possible.
Okay.
It is not humanly possible to do.
And 12, Andrea Trezevan. Now, I've heard this. Did he race RCGP? He made an RC2.
Maybe some. No, but he has been fast, really fast in Italy. Mm-hmm. So it's not a surprise. I mean, he did switch. He was running HB before he switched to WRC.
Yeah.
So good.
Congratulations to WRC. Had a car in there. Actually, I see that team's growing quite well all over, to be honest. So good stuff for him. Good job for him. I mean, he should be happy to. I would be happy with making that main. And then Barufalo. Man, Barufalo, I think. Yeah, Barufalo 13th. I think that's where, like, Barufalo was not, like, was he good at the warm-up? I don't think.
I think he was okay.
Yeah. This boy is going to be a challenge for Barufalo, I think, this track.
Yeah. I think the world's track will be more his cup of tea.
Yeah. So, yeah. But that's your top 13 that made it through and made it to the first Euro since 2019. So that was good to have that back. It's been 3 years almost.
Another, like, actually, Alex Sanketin was much faster than what the results indicate.
Mm-hmm.
But he also had his one of his rounds, 11th place, disqualified. So he then had, typical Alex fashion, he had like a, I don't know, 17, 18, and 121 that counted. And that put him in the maybe 16th final. And then he had flame out or flame outs, and he didn't bump. Or did he bump once and then his second final had issues? But his lap times were really good. So, yeah, he was fast, but didn't make it happen.
Other surprises are Jorn 17th, was it? Yeah, not too bad.
He was very strong in qualifying, so yeah. I almost expected a bit more.
Miguel Matias 16th. Wow, that is not bad for a guy who just like
that's fucking amazing. I mean, last time he came back, just did the Euros and he made the main. Yes, it is Portugal, but still, like, even if it's in your home country and you sort of quit and come back and make a main, that's really impressive.
Wow, that is very impressive. Ricardo Montero, I think you'd be happy with that. Hampus, like I said, we is impressed with.
Where did Montero finish?
He finished just below 18th.
Yeah, I would assume he would have wanted to be in the main.
Okay, I mean, is he that good?
Yeah, I think so. Okay. Especially in his home country.
Yeah,
his track. Yeah,
Hampus. Hampus, man, he'll be there next year. Savoia on the 27th. I think Savoia's times her. Like, this is the transition from.
I think that, like I have said before, Savoia needs balls, and especially on a track like this, give Savoy some balls, please. Let's start a petition, maybe a GoFundMe.
Do you think he'll get some balls in here to go faster?
Oh, for sure. Savoy needs balls to go.
So you don't think it's age?
Responsibility? I mean, that too, you know, running his web shop, having a family, all kinds of other things on his mind. That and lack of balls. That's it. But even I was surprised seeing his consistent 20th place finishes. Like, what the fuck is going on? Like, yeah.
Dude, yeah. Wolanka beat you. Oh my God. Wolanka came out of retirement and beat
you. Yeah. He was actually good too. Wolanka, yeah.
What is he driving, a Mugen?
Fucking Wolanka. He drove a Mugen, I think, yeah.
Is he still crazy?
I think he is, yes. But he's coming back now to race more RC. I'm happy.
Oh, good. He's good. The English had a bad run. I mean, the highest look, the Skidmore. I know Johnny kind of flamed out, but William was the top English guy, 25th. No, well, Boots, obviously, but besides Boots, William Skidmore. Paulson finished 30th. Oh, well, look at that. Yeah. Look at that. Jessica Paulskin. It's like,
who did I beat? Like, who's right behind me? Read out the names behind me.
Pelle Comse. Pelle Comse. Alejandro Perez, a junior. Brian Baldo.
Oh, no.
Jerome Aiguan. Jordan Lott. You beat Wolanka. Well done. Yes. You beat Tom Robin. He beat you. Did he beat you at RCGP? You beat John Skidmore. You beat Lee Martin.
Skidmore.
Bloomfield.
Skidmark. I
was shocked to see Bloomfield there, too.
Yeah, Bloomfield's back. Nah,
I hope he comes to RCGP.
No, he said he wouldn't.
Oh, shit. And,
so I beat some big names, actually.
Oh, you beat Majube, too.
Majube. Ever since he left JQ, he's not been the same.
So you can take
Majube saved my Euros. You know, when I arrived, I hadn't prepared my car at all. So I need, because no, we had a Finnish national. Actually, hey, won the Finnish championship, by the way. We haven't covered that on the podcast.
We talked really about that last time you was here.
Did we?
Yes.
I forgot. I just wanted to do that. 20 years ago, I won the first one. Amazing. Anyway, that's why my car wasn't done. So show up. They wouldn't let anyone in the facility. Couldn't go in the pits. So I was screwed. But Majube was there with their camper. They had set up tables. So I said, hey, mind if I join you? And they didn't mind. Amazing. So they set up a table and a chair for me. And I rebuilt my car right there and then in the road.
Typical.
Got a picture of that.
Typical of you. Typical
of you. I will find a picture of that.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's about it that I wanted to talk about on the names there. Any else you want to say that you really enjoyed about the jurors before we go on? Because I know you have some complaints. Because it can't be a race without you complaining about something. But I wanted to ask, did you ever investigate that what I asked you about? About Canassa and Q5?
What was that?
About what anyway, I will talk about it later.
Canassa in Q5.
If he was over on his tank.
Oh, no, I never did.
Yeah, I never heard it from nobody else either, so I just kind of left it at that. All right. Anything else you want to add? Stop focusing on that. Let's focus. We got to finish up talking about the Euros. What am I looking for? I have no idea what you're looking for. You started going on some tangent.
Oh, yeah. Working on the car in the street.
Yeah, how you was unprepared, as usual.
No, when I was serious and not retired, I was prepared.
Oh, so tell us about the
7 euros. How, amen, buddy.
Yeah, but you were so proud about how Team Finland rallied around Juna Hattinen and Pekka Ivonen and helped them out. That's what you was telling me about. And we gave them this and we helped them out.
Yeah, getting them tires and setups. And dude, actually, that's good. That's a good reminder. Pekka owes me 2 servos, a cone rod, an 8mm Venturi. And I bet you there's something else too. Had to give
how are these kids getting to Euros so unprepared? and still able to perform well, do well.
I also gave him a Venturi, told him to get rid of one shim in the shim from the engine.
So you helped him. That's what you're saying. You unfucked their cars.
Yeah, that whole Finnish team was helping them.
Yeah, because, and you know what? You was really good on the microphone too, by the way. People really enjoyed having you on there. Really? It was very good.
What did I say?
You lots of shit, but you was really good.
Should have sold more courses. God damn it.
Yeah.
Still broke.
Invisible speed.
We did get over 200 people on there now.
Oh, that's good. That's great. That's good. That's awesome. And you know what? The sale's still going on, people. 20% off.
Since we won the Euros, still 20% off for this week.
Yeah, 20% off. You know what? Just because we like it, we're going to have another Invisible Speed ad, and then we're going to go into the rant and conclusion.
Yeah, focus.
Right, yeah, so everybody remember the Invisible Speed online course is still 20% off. Sign up, just over 200 people there. JQ, it's all about Invisible Speed. It's the future. A lot of people really are enjoying the course and all of that good stuff. JQ is now probably texting Pecco saying, you owe me an 8mm and this, and you know him. He's He's all happy about that. So tell me, you was a little bit upset. You said you couldn't eat, you guys couldn't eat in the pits. And what you mean security was tight? Like, what was that all about?
Do we have to, should we do this rant now? The fucking Portuguese rant.
No, because it's a good podcast.
Okay,
let's
do it. We'll do it real quick. There's something weird going on in Portugal. Maybe it's the Atlantic Ocean. Something in the water. I don't know. God.
I can see that this is going to be a bad rant. We better stop right now.
No, let's cover this now.
This is going to be like Jeff.
We're not going to get back to this. Portugal is a country that has all the elements of this laid back Southern European, almost like a Latin America. You know how it is. Like even in the Dominican Republic, it's like, do what you want. No rules kind of place, right? It has all those elements. People are relaxed, like, well, park anywhere, you know. Oh, it's a red light, who cares? Like, there's this mentality, right? Yet at the same time, they are the most uptight, follow the rules ridiculously to the T people you can ever meet. It's unbelievable. I have only once had a shipment actually destroyed by customs. I'll never forget it. I even remember her name. Vanessa Fonseca was her name. She worked for DHL in Lisbon. Sent back then, it was Miguel Matias who was running the JQ car. Sent a couple of cars over. We did everything in our power to get those cars. Sent proof of payment, proof of this and that, explaining everything. Everything is clear, right? Sponsorship. This is the cost of the car, everything. What do we need to pay? Just tell us what to pay. We'll pay it. Nothing. Can you send it somewhere else? Can you return it? Nothing. Basically, the only option was to destroy the goods. So they destroyed the cars. Right?
I forgot. I forgot about your infamous story when you went to Portugal.
I'm Portuguese national champion. I'm going to claim that. Because
no, I wasn't talking about that.
Yeah, I'm going to claim that because that's another thing. Like, I was leading the championships back in, I don't know, 2007 or 8. 8. 2008, I think. And so I did the Portuguese championship, all three rounds or whatever. And I was leading the championship. Basically, I was going to win unless Miguel Matias would win the last race. Now, I took a gamble. I'm like, he's not going to win. He's running a GS, kind of shitty. This track, he's not going to win on this track. So I didn't go. I went to the Nordics instead. So then he has an issue in the semifinal. So he's not going to make the main, not going to win. And they stop the race. They say that they have some computer problem, right? And then it was such a massive problem that they couldn't run the main. So you know what they did? They gave everyone maximum points. So besides, I finished like third in the championship or something. Like everyone who was there got maximum points. So like the Portugal, my relationship to Portugal
is really
is a weird one.
It is. There because are you had really another incident there.
Another incident?
Yeah, we had it. Remember, when, I think you told the story on the podcast about when you had to go down there and never mind. We never said the country, so probably what? Now people know now.
What?
Didn't what, you have an issue with that? Didn't you have an issue with like a dealer down there at one point?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that too. So then yeah another thing, this one dealer who was working together with a Spanish distributor. It's so long ago, we can tell the story.
You told it already.
Working together with a Spanish distributor. And what they would do is they would combine their orders, and then Spanish guy would pay the Portuguese guy, and he would then pay that order. And then this one time, he just kept the money. Never sent the money. Or the Spanish guy's going nuts. Like, fuck, I paid this guy like 15,000 euros or whatever it was, right? Like, what the hell? So then months go by, and then we're like, fuck it, we're just gonna have to go there. So we went, I flew to Portugal. The Spanish guys drove over, and we went, they had a hobby shop, right? So we went to the hobby shop, and incredibly, like, we go there to scout the location, like, okay, what are we gonna do? Like, what if they aren't here? Like, we can't spend too many days here, you know, waiting for them. And lo and behold, fucking that hobby shop owner and his wife just walk by us at a red light close to the hobby shop. So we're like, what are we going to do now? It's Sunday. The banks aren't even open. So we're just we don't know if we're ever going to see these guys again during this trip. Let's just get them now. So we got them, go in the hobby shop, wait until Monday morning, go in the bank, get the money.
Yeah, you have a love-hate relationship with Portugal.
All these things, like, with Portugal, it's like one hand, it's this like DR style, we're going to do what we want atmosphere. But then on the other, it's really following rules to the T. And then the third is like combining those two. So you create your own rules and you follow them to the T. You know?
Mm-hmm.
It makes no sense to me. So you aren't actually following rules. You also make them up just to fucking piss other people off or make life hard for someone else. That's my feeling. And that's exactly how it was at this Euros. It's fucking incredible. So can you imagine this? Yeah, it's a European Championship. There's a ton of people there. It's really hot. Of course, we can have water in the pits. No beer allowed. No alcohol in the pits. Food. No food allowed. Someone had Pringles. They couldn't bring Pringles in. Okay, obviously, you know me. I'm not going to put up with that bullshit. I figured out a hack immediately. Just walk around the track the other direction, other way. And then there's a gap in the fence and walk in. So what we did was, Team Finland, we started doing that. So we just, one guy goes, buys all the food, and then walks back with it that other way. And then the guard isn't there. Everyone starts eating. One is looking like, hey, guard's coming. Better hurry up. Finish that kebab. You know? So it was ridiculous.
Why was no food?
They said that there's some law there that sporting events, you can't have food or something. But once again, it's this bullshit rule. Like, come on. Are you serious?
So that's why the guards were super tough. That's what
Yeah.
Interesting. That's interesting.
Yeah. Okay. So let's continue the story here. That's actually what I sent you a picture of, remember?
Mm-hmm.
Because another thing. We have passes. So we had this normal card pass and then a sort of neck band that said driver or mechanic. we also had a wristband that said driver mechanic. So then there were cases of a mechanic not being allowed to go in to pit someone because he just had the mechanic badge around his neck. He didn't have the wristband. What the fuck? Like, why do you need a wristband and that other thing to get in? Like, two different things you needed.
Oh, a lot of rules. Legal. A lot of rules. A lot of security. Right?
Yeah. It was insane.
What? Why was so much security? Like,
I don't know. But then,
maybe as you finish, guys.
No. So anyway, we have established that there were plenty of rules here, right? 16% fuel was something you had to run, basically. There's no way around that. I heard from some people that on a practice day at the track, the police, or whoever polices fuel, I don't know, what's the word, like anti-terrorist agency they have, they had shown up at the track to make sure that no one was running over 16% fuel. Can you believe
that? You know what it is? Everybody wants to get some money. That's what it sounds like to me. Sounds like a lot of open-air corruption like her. Everybody wants to get a little piece of the pie.
Yeah, anyway.
That's crazy that they showed up for that. I bet you. Did you have issues coming through customs with your stuff?
No, there's no customs.
Really?
Well, because it's EU. That's the thing.
I don't know if you guys had to
go through customs. But anyway, so get this.
Yeah, that was a little extreme. I wonder, but then if you know what, maybe it was for good reasons, because if the freaking anti-terrorist squad is showing off to make sure you guys ain't running more than 25% nitro.
Yeah, maybe they should have
if they would have caught you eating a bag of chips in the pits, you probably would have been in jail.
I know, and this is the thing that's crazy. Kind of annoys me about it. Kind of reminded me about the fact that how in many ways Portugal is a great country, but I just couldn't live there because of the RC people that I know are really nice, like Miguel, Monteiro, Rui, all the, like Ricardo Costa, who's been working with me on the car, like they're all super nice, right? But like when you go somewhere like a restaurant, hotels, this fucking tech guy, who I had issues with also, but it's just the attitude somehow, like they go out of their way to make your life miserable. It's fucking unbelievable. Like we had some incredible restaurant encounters too. This guy, first we sit down at a table, right? We're there for like 10 minutes. Nothing's happening. Like finally someone walks up. He literally asks us, do we want the menu? We're like, no, we just walked in this restaurant. We're just sitting here at this table shooting the shit. Like, we actually don't want any drinks or any food. And we don't want the menu. So then he walks off, and I'm like, you want to bet he brings one menu? And then he's like, do you all want menus? He brought like three menus. We were like seven people or something.
It's your hair. He didn't like your hair.
No, it's just like every little fucking thing is like that. And then this same place. Okay, let me finish this rant. This is actually a good one. So this place was the place we went for dessert. He got like every single order wrong. He mistook cup for crepe. Okay, so the people who ordered just ice cream in a cup got crepes with just ice cream on them. Okay. But not only that, because he said, oh, crepe or cup, same to me. Yeah, well, why the fuck is my ice cream mango when I ordered vanilla? Is like vanilla and mango also the same? And then I had an order with an actual crepe, with all everything on it except Nutella. What do I get? I get a crepe with just ice cream on it. I'm like, where's everything else? Jesus Christ. Like, I'm telling you, they're doing it intentionally.
They don't like you. I don't like you.
It's not just me either. Seriously. Like, there is something in the water in Portugal. I'm telling you.
Well,
And you know what?
Can you unshare this so I can share my next video very shortly? Go ahead. Continue your rant.
I have unshared it. Oh. So, yeah, I don't know. Like, maybe, like, even Quail, you know? We created CTO. And now he has un-CTO'd himself. Like, now it's almost like CTO lives on through Canas. Canas takeout instead of Coelho takeout, right?
Well, but he did get taken out.
Yeah, but it's like, maybe this is why Coelho used to be that way. Because he grew up in Portugal, you know. Let's just ruin other people for no good reason. You know, that just transferred over to his driving, like. And we could sort of smack that out of him. So maybe that's just it.
I think everybody in Portugal hates you now. I think I want to go Portugal bad. I love Portuguese people. So you've just now ostracized yourself in Portugal even more with your love-hate relationship with Portugal. Because you had bad experiences.
They know it's true. They know
maybe it's true. Your language barrier, maybe.
They know it's true. Okay. If they are honest, they know it's true.
So that was your one negative side of your trip.
Because I've had this same discussion with Miguel Matias in the past, and he agrees.
Okay. All right. Now let's get on to some real ranting here.
Okay, what's that?
Some RC ranting. Let's watch this video.
And happening. Oh! That's not popular. Let's see that one again. I think we're just getting the focus in. We got there. Hattonen comes up the inside. Ooh, well, I'm not sure that one's going to get allowed. So Hattonen clips Morente 40. What was that? So an error there. I think it's a. And it's Canas and Bruno come together. I don't think anyone's. We'll see whether anyone gets called for that one.
Okay, so the quality of the second one isn't that great.
Why? What the hell? Was that thing with a potato?
No, I got them off. That's what I got off of RC Racing TV.
Fuck that up. Anyway, let's take the first one first, okay?
because you complained about Portugal, now you're going to complain about that anyway. It looks good on the south end. All right.
Let me guess. You asked a favor for a Portuguese guy, and he sent you that.
See, no, I got that.
Okay.
Oh my God, you are not allowed in Portugal anymore.
The first, well, too bad we have a bunch of races coming up there. The first one, that was Joona Hatanen on Pariente in the LCQ. There are many, many reasons why I think the fact he did get a penalty. I had conflicting things. I heard he didn't get a penalty for that. I heard there was some kind of contact earlier with someone else.
Oh, I didn't see that.
So, because I don't know what happened, let's just focus on this. Let's just see. Okay, is this a penalty or not? I think definitely not. At an RCGP, it wouldn't have been. Why? Because there's a rule. If your front tires, if you're on the inside of the corner, you have a clean shot on the inside, go by, and your tires are ahead. Your front tires are ahead of the other guy's rear tires. You are not taking him out. If you are going in that same direction, if you slow that down or stop it, you can see that Jonas practically already passed the guy. Like, Pariente jumps wide, Jonas jumps to the inside. His car is further down the track than Pariente. They touch. Pariente exits stage right. Yes, it looks bad, but he left the door open. He left the door open. Joona dove in. He was already ahead. Boom, they touched. I don't think Joona intentionally wanted to take him out. He wanted to get by. They happened to touch, and that was it. Had Pariente been closer to the corner, Joona hit him in the back. Yes, definitely penalty. But he didn't. He was ahead already. Second thing, when it's a questionable situation, like, let's say, this happened really fast. What happens? It's a last chance qualifier. You should be way more lenient with penalties in the last chance qualifier. because you don't want to cause someone to not make the main because you gave them a penalty, a questionable penalty. Because as drivers, we know we're going to do anything to make that main, right? So we all have that mentality. So if there's a situation where someone gets taken out questionably, someone else makes it, it's bad, but I think it is worse when someone gets a penalty that's not deserved. And we've seen that in the past with Barufula and Martin Baia, where I think Martin Baia got a penalty and Barufula made the main because of that penalty, and the penalty was not deserved. You can see that on the video. That's worse, far worse. So for those two reasons, that was not a penalty in my opinion.
Well, you know what? The internet actually agrees with you. So I, you know, the most of the comments agree that the first one was a racing incident. But yeah. I also think the second one was a racing incident.
There is no way. Play that shit again.
Oh my God. Where is it? Hold on.
And Hattonen. Oh, that's not popular. Let's see that one again. I think we're here. We're just getting the focus in. We got there.
Can you stop Hattonen it right at the
comes up
stop
the
it there?
Ooh, well, I'm not sure that one's going to get allowed. So Hattonen.
Do you have Marenzi control of this or what?
40. What was that? So an error there. I think it's a. Oh, and it's Canas and Bruno come together. I don't think anyone's. We'll just see whether anyone gets called for that one.
Man, that was close, dude. It was close.
Do you not control the? You didn't hear what I said, like to pause it.
I can't control it. I'm looking for the video now. Don't worry. Right. Just talk.
Well, anyway, the first one here. If you could pause it, you would have seen Jonas' head. The second one is a clear penalty. You either wait or you get a penalty. That was in the main.
Yeah, that was in the main. That was near the end of the.
Yeah, that was bad. I mean, that Canas was taking the normal line. Coelho was going tight, and he jumped further than he should have. You know, he jumped further than normal, landed, hit Canas, and Canas flips. That's a clear. There's zero. I mean, yeah, maybe it was a mistake. Maybe it was like subconscious CTO coming back. We don't know. But yes, racing incident or not, that was a penalty for sure.
Okay. So, Max made a comment. I don't know. He's is this normal? Like, it, you know, is this normal for, I mean, you give a, if you not got a penalty, actually, I, at the time when we was watching this, we thought he got two penalties, to be honest.
I don't know.
But, you know, and I remember I asked you, I said, Jason, did he get two penalties for that? And he's like, no, he just got one. He was on a different fuel. Let's see if I can hold on. Oh no.
Without the pit stop or without the penalty, he would have made the main.
Oh man, this is bad. All right, let's see if I can share this and we can see it. So, yeah, I definitely think Yuno shouldn't have been called for that if he got called for that. If he got called for that, then everything to me says what I keep hearing about, like, races in these areas. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. Finn hinting a Spanish guy, you know which way that's going to go.
Yeah,
when Max Portuguese said, on Spanish, that's a tough thing.
Yeah, Max so said it's a coin toss. But yeah, that's I felt bad for Yuno. That was unfair. I think he needed to get in front, especially in the LCQ. You have to go for it. When do you go for
well,
it?
Well, even if that Coelho one on Canas was in an LCQ, that's a penalty, okay?
Are you just being biased because
no, I'm not. Coelho. Watch it. Fucking stop the video. It's a clear as day.
It seems to not be wanting to cooperate today. Can you see the video?
Well, yeah, but it still looks like shit.
It's going to look like
quality.
because it's not good quality.
Stop it there. Can you fucking
stop it on slow motion? There we go.
No. Okay, what's there? Who's ahead right now?
Hattonen.
Yeah. Okay. Case closed. It's not a fucking penalty.
Yeah, I agree. There's not a penalty.
He made a mistake. He went wide.
Let's see. Oh, wow. This is really bad quality. It looked so much better on the phone.
Okay.
I'll go to when it's in slow motion. We get it better.
You see those pixels? Even from these pixels, you can tell. Look. Okay, watch this now. Watch. Stop it. Well, right, you stopped a bit late, but look. I mean, come on. Kanas is taking the line that everyone took so they can carry their momentum into the triple jump. Koelho is like maybe a flashback to the old days. It's like, I can get to the inside. Fucking yeah, CTO, man. Like
you can see it right here. Like Kanas is coming in for his normal line.
Yes.
And then Coelho just trying to get it in there. But to be fair, Coelho was all up Kanas's ass the entire, like it was, I mean... Well, to
maybe
be fair,
he was getting fucking frustrated, but he should have launched that
right.
Jump
but he, I mean, even at the beginning of the race, he was late breaking, and people were saying that's just touring car style racing right there. I was like, this is gonna happen at some point. I'm surprised it didn't happen more. But now that I looked at it and slid it on, and also the pixels, the blurs, that I would have to agree because you can see where Kanas was pointed in the right direction to take his normal line, and he's probably just about to get on the throttle, and then that's when Coelho pipped him, and there was no call. So,
yeah, maybe yeah. He didn't see it.
Maybe. How many refs did they have up there?
If Stetson saw that and didn't give a penalty, then I'd be very surprised.
Well, Stetson wasn't there, or was it?
What do you mean? Stetson was the referee.
Oh, he was there. Okay, maybe he missed that one. He also doesn't have. Do they do his video replay at all?
No.
Okay. JQ, we've been going on for 2 hours. Now all of Portugal hate you. Not me.
Well, not Monteiro, Rui, Ricardo Costa, or Matias.
Right. But anyway, this dude, you won your first Euros. Congratulations. Before we go, Visions race this week. I think Mayfield, Rifkin, Thibaut, Stefan Dalen, Pavides, Cole Ogden. The only thing it's like, it's like RCGP. It's only like 15, 20 people signed up to go.
That's the whole point. That's how you should do a show race like this.
No, hopefully, but this
format is good and the coverage is good.
Right. But at this show, you kind of, at this place, because there's going to be spectators there, this is the race that you want a lot of, not a lot, but you at least want to, you know, to have.
Isn't there an open class also?
Yes, that's what I mean. There's an open, that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah. That's but the pro class, it's like only.
Right, the pro class is fine. It doesn't have Fenn because TLR is going to ENATS. But no Cav. But from what I saw, it had about 12 decent guys. But I'm talking about the open class, only has 15 entries.
Oh, like really?
Yeah, man. I'm so upset because I kind of okay.
That possible? I would have thought that would be
fun. Actually, here's my rant that I wanted to start, and I want people to think about this. So I was saving this rant from last week. Now, it might be more people. It might be more people signed up. So I was having a great conversation the other day. I'm glad you're here because it was about you too. And here's this race, right, Joseph, that I think that if you had a USA driver, I would be like, Joseph, you need to be at this race. You need to go to this race. You need to do it big. Like, you know what I mean? Because this race is going to have spectators, all the type of stuff. I understand that it's on the ENATS time and that it's kind of hard. It's kind of not difficult to get to, but it's like it's not an easy place to fly into. Apparently, a lot of people are driving there. I understand that it's also expensive. What I also heard was told that they waived the $150 fee that was attached that you get the wristband so you can go around and see all the rest of the stuff. So my thoughts was this all last week. And I want you to think about this. And I want you guys as viewers to think about this. So yes, we need the ENATS and it's important. And people are upset because it's on the same weekend as the ENATS. But we have to think about, this is something that RCGP has always tried to say. It's not just about individual sales. It's about coming together as an industry to make the race, the industry better for everybody. So let's look at these two races. We got everything we want here. We got a race that's being put on by Live RC. Joe is building the track. Scotty's there. You know, all these good people involved in it that everybody likes in RC. A-Man's all on board. You know, all this type of stuff. But yet, not every manufacturer is there supporting it. Like TLR, like I'm so shocked that TLR is not there. Like this is right up their alley. They got all that ready-to-run stuff, the crawlers and rock racers and all that stuff.
We have a Horizon Fest.
You know, right, but they should be going to this race. They're going to the ENATS.
Yeah, you know, no shit.
Like, this is our
Raw should have moved that ENATS, to be honest.
Probably. But listen, this is the one race where we kind of have to put our best foot forward. Like, this is what we asked for. It's going to be on MAV TV, not live, I don't think, but like a finished one-hour production. Like, all this stuff. I just think like this is the race that we should all, like the manufacturer should get behind and support. This race is what will help, in my opinion, RC and the RC racing grow as a whole versus the ENATS, which is about individual sales.
We've been over this so many times.
Right.
These kind of races, listen, it's one part of the fucking pie.
Yes, I get that. I understand that, Joseph. But it comes down to this. Everybody said RCGP was because of you. Right, nobody, the manufacturers didn't join because of you,
yeah,
which is true to an extent.
And it's not, I've always said it's not.
But look at this, everybody's favorite people are involved in this, and still we don't have all the manufacturers involved in this. And they should be. If you, like I said, if you had a USA driver and you know, all that going, I would be like, yeah, they should be at this race because this is what we put our first, this is like what we want, spectators and on TV and all this type of stuff. I'm waiting to see how they do it. But I just feel like, I understand that this was short notice as well. I get that. I get a lot of things. But this is just one of them races where you just kind of be like, all right, we find the budget to do it, in my opinion. It has to be done. Has to be. So I believe they're going to be doing it again next year because this is going to be a permanent RC track, apparently.
Okay,
so next year hopefully it's bigger. But I want you guys to think which so this is going to be my question for the viewers: what race is better for RC as a whole versus what race is better for individual companies? Let me know in the comments of this podcast. Also, to the nation of Portugal, the words that came out of this green herd's man's mouth do not reflect the words of the No Name RC podcast on myself. I want to come to Portugal. I love Portuguese people.
Yeah.
Shout out to
even though you know, I'm right.
Salty Joe is gonna not like what you just said about Portugal.
He will agree. So anyway, what about the coverage of the Euros? Yes, Invisible Speed sponsored all of that.
Yes.
Come on. No press conferences, no interviews, really.
Yeah, there was.
Not much going on. Like, there were a few interviews.
Lot on the virtual. Well, see, you didn't see the virtual side of
that. Okay. So how was it then in that?
I think, from what I
have seen, it's like, come on, we have to at least get the budget so they can all show up and do best work at the Euros.
They needed more people, hands on. It was only Nick, James, and Zach there,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, like. It's the Euros. For fuck's sake, EFRA. You've got 200,000 euros in the bank. Spend some fucking money and do some good coverage.
Yeah.
You've got sponsors paying. Like, what are we paying for? You know?
The coverage was good, though. People enjoyed it. The coverage was good. But like I said, they didn't have the press
coverage of the actual racing. Yes.
Yes. And then Nick was good doing his stuff, but they can only do so much with three people.
Exactly. And there's no excuse for that because we know how to do it better.
Yeah,
and they know how to do it better.
But it was, answer I think is, they did
spend a bit more money, get the resources they need. Then they can
they definitely tell need all of these, to the ground there.
Tell all of these stories that are happening at the race. Right? They can go.
Well, they had you there. Interview you drivers. Was doing a good job with that.
What?
You was doing a good job with that in the announce move.
I was there for like 10 minutes, whatever. That's different. They can...
But I
walk
agree
around, see the drivers, talk to drivers, talk about what's happening in the race, you know, make it more interesting for
people. Yeah, but they can only do what they can do. with limited people. And I was shocked that they only had
that
many.
They can do it all if all the people that are needed go there because they have the budget. And EFRA has no excuse for not spending that money.
A, for what they had, I think the production was great. The virtual side of it was great.
Grow RC. It needs to be better next year. Come on.
Okay, I agree with you. They need to get more boots on the ground there.
Yeah,
I agree with you. But they have to go. They have to do things within budget. I think Matt's going to be on the road for 36 days from here on out. So they're also thinking of that. They have a lot of races coming up.
Well, there are other people, not just Matt.
But I think for the minimum amount of people that they had, they did a good job. And on the virtual side, they did a good job. Yeah. Anything is, I don't know why I was so pixelated. I agree. When I heard it was, and RCGP has more than that when they go to a race. What is it? We had Nick. When we went to South Carolina, we had Nick, the two cameraman, Matt. What's his name? Oh, I knew his name, man. James. So that's five right there. And then at RCGP here recently, we had Frank, Ben, you know, it was just, you know, so it's hard to do all that with a little bit of people. And then, you know, Matt's at home. He's the editing mastermind and all that stuff too. So he's got to control it from him. It's different from being there, you know. But they did a good job for the amount of people that they had, the amount of budget that they had, in my opinion. And I was involved in it. And I'm going to be involved in the on-road large-scale touring car worlds this weekend.
When is that?
This weekend. My dream class.
Fifth scale
on-road. But yeah, I agree. Get more people to do. They need more people to do a better job to do.
Yeah, it's,
you know,
about time now. Let's get this shit sorted out.
But I don't think it's not RC Racing TV's fault.
We haven't. We have.
I'm just making
EFRA
that clear.
Jesus Christ.
Just because you start complaining
and just say how it is.
You know what? You're starting to get too complainy. You should be in a joyous mood. Be happy, JQ. You just won a European championship.
Yeah. So can we have a fucking press conference for it? Let's do it. EFRA have had this before. They have used to do this. Don't go backwards. Go forwards. Hashtag grow RC. Let's do this.
You know what? I knew it would be too good to be true that you would not have any complaints. You have full of complaints.
This is the rant section. We rant. Okay? Don't be a pussy now.
I'm not being a pussy. I had to tell you that this weekend, by the way. Do you remember that?
I was ranting.
Yeah, man. Congratulations to you. Congratulations. I mean, to everybody involved. Besides you complaining about the rules being too strict, it was a good event, man.
Rules in the pits.
It was a good event.
It was a great event. Like facility, attention to detail, like David said, all the past Euros and Worlds results, pictures.
That looked nice.
Was there a video of that or pictures?
Yeah.
In the preparation area under the driver stand. I mean, it was world class.
Yeah.
Definitely.
It'd be nice to get a world. Hopefully that's true. And we have the first e-buggy Worlds there next year.
Yeah. You know, it's that last.
There, you can rejuvenate your
detail.
Career.
Last bit of attention to detail and caring.
Yeah.
Now, if only these same kind of people would make it into EFRA.
I agree if you're there.
Imagine how good it could be.
I agree. Well, JQ, thanks. It was a good chance chatting with you as well. I just want to reiterate to Portugal, I do not feel the same way.
Stop it. Stop with the disclaimers, okay?
I'm disclaiming you.
Just stop it. So
I'm
next
disclaiming
rant,
you.
Next rant, let's just put it out there already. Control tires. Hot topic. We're going to have to start pushing control tires.
Really? At these races?
Yep, we are.
Why? To cut down costs?
Yes. It's getting too competitive.
Well,
don't
I mean,
have the right tire.
Hot race, congratulations to them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 at this race.
yeah, it's getting too competitive. And I'm not saying this because of the best drivers. I'm saying this because of all the other drivers who go there and pay their own way and pay for tires.
But the Euros, are the Euro 10 scales, are they spec tires?
10 scale is spec tire, but somehow magically in 8 scale it doesn't work. On-road, spec tire. Every other class, full-scale racing, spec tires. 8 scale nitro off-road, somehow, no, spec tires can't work. Of course it works. It's cheaper for everyone, better for everyone. It's a few races a year that are like this. Big, important championships, people travel to internationally. Make it cheaper and easier for people to attend and more fair, and racing will be better too. We should actually have, we should find drivers with balls who will come on here and state their honest opinion about control tires. Okay. So it's not just me and you doing the talking, and we should push this through because I think it really can, it can really be a good thing. Rotate the manufacturers. There are billions of other races in the world that people, or they can sell tires to. If one year their tire isn't a spec tire at the Euros, no, it's not such a big deal.
Something to think about. It's going to meet a lot of resistance, though.
Yeah,
it's going to meet a lot of resistance.
We have a project now.
Right. Well, JQ, I'm going to let you go. It was good chatting with you. We have the big show next week, big 200. So get ready for that. We're going to be probably coordinating with Nick from TZO to do something with that.
Which day is that going to be?
I haven't figured that out yet. I'm thinking a Wednesday. Next Wednesday might be good, okay. But we kind of have to figure out where you can be. So you might have to get some sleep. And have fun at the Finnish Nationals this weekend, me and a mechanic.
It's not now. There's no racing now until RCGP first week of August.
Oh, okay. I thought you said you had one this weekend. And, but you said you're not going to race RCGP.
Yeah, I'm going there to pit for whoever we can rent.
Yeah, JQ's looking for a driver for RCGP. Preferably if you live in the UK. It'd be cheaper for him.
Yeah. Is Bloomfield sponsored by Associated?
Probably. Most likely. He was like, I'm going to pilfer Associated's drivers. Yeah, you ain't getting Bloomfield. Anyway, man, seriously, though, congratulations. I know it's been a long time coming. Happy for you. Happy for me. I'm, you know, happy for all the old JQ guys.
Yeah, it's good.
It's good.
It, I haven't been on social media to see what people say, if there's negativity or this also out there. But honestly, I only really, like, I just care about the fact that it's done now, like on a personal level. So
I haven't seen much. There's some people that throw a little shade. Oh, he can win any car. He can win for skateboard. He can win with this. He can win this. Tell people out there that think that these guys can win with anything, that what you think about that. What would you say to that?
They can win if they are at the race with people who make those kind of comments, but they can't win when they are at the race against their peers. Like, that's quite disrespectful to Kanas and Koelho and Ongaro and all these guys to say that David can win with anything, you know? Can they all win with anything? Then why don't they all win all the time? Like, it doesn't make any sense. It's a stupid argument, and me and Max will actually break this down in a future YouTube video. This was already, I think, even mentioned before. Like, this was something, like, maybe a month ago that we decided we were going to do.
Cool.
Because of these type of comments. So that's a video that we'll do at some point here in the summer.
Sweet. All right, guys. Well, like I said, to watch this week, you have the Visions race coming up, and I believe that the ENATS will have some coverage. But I'm really interested to see in the Visions race, what they're going to do. I hope they do a good job. And I wish them all the best of luck doing it, because I know how hard that is. But they have a good team, it seems. JQ, David, all you guys, congratulations once again. Congratulations to the Mayako NPC. Congratulations to y'all, Figurator, and his family for pulling off a great event. I know it was emotional for those guys. And, yeah, beautiful facility, man. I hope to see it one day. I hope to see it one day. Joseph, I'm going to let you go.
Wait.
And what happened?
I have something to say.
Oh.
I put on my motion blocking glasses.
Yeah, but we can see what you're working on.
Hold on, I'm doing.
Right, just... Did you cry?
No.
Okay.
So next 2 months, there's only two races now. So there's going to be a lot going on in the Mayako performance community. I mean, a better reason. We can't get a better reason for people to join now than a European Championship and now preparing for the World Championships. And also Invisible Speed. Next week, we will have live videos for all the people who sign up now, so we can catch up to the other people who have already been on the program. And then later on, we'll have another week where we analyze the Euros, and also it's the second week of live videos going over the homework we've done and talking about new topics and giving out new homework. So the Invisible Speed thing, even though it's an online course and the videos are already done, it's also interactive with live meetings and sort of an agenda throughout the year. And finally, I want to say a big thank you to all the people over the years who have supported JQ Products, then JQ Racing, and now Mayako, because this would not have happened without all of that support. And surprisingly many are still with us. They have joined us from the very beginning or from early on, somewhere along the way, and they have continued the journey into Mayako. And I really hope that this is now the beginning of something to where I can actually fulfill all the promises that I've made to people like just like that, who have joined because of the vision, because of the dream and the idea. Now I hope that we can get to that position where we can do really fun and cool things together. So that's, yeah, that was my final thoughts.
Yeah, it feels good to win, doesn't it?
I think that having tried to get to this point for so long, it's going to take a while to sink in.
Yeah.
The biggest feeling I had really was just of like a relief, sort of emptiness. Not like euphoria or happiness, just like empty, like, fuck.
Finally, yeah.
So yeah,
it's kind of, I was happy. I was just like, oh, fuck, like that one missing ingredient, like, you know what I mean? Now more to come. I'm happy for you too, man. And yeah, that's a good saying, because all the people and that supported that also are big supporters of this. So, you know, it's all one big thing. We got going on here. So thank you to everybody that supported JQ Racing over the years. I know it's not been easy. I myself know that for a fact. And thank you to, I guess, like same to you. Like, those are the same people that helped me get where I am. You know what I mean? Or where this is going. So same people that helped out there, the same people, not just, you know, as, you know what I mean? And the same people that will continue to watch. But yeah, it's good, man. It's good to not be an underdog. Like, it's now time, you know, we've been underdog for 10 years. Now it's time to be top dog. So
exactly.
And I think personally, the industry was shook this weekend. Everything was Invisible Speed, RCGP, and Mayako wins. Yeah, like it's like in the Marvel universe, I mean in DC universe, like they had the multiverse or something, like reverse universe. Yeah. People must think they're like in a reverse universe right now. Signing David Ronnefalk, you know, 6 months later, winning the Euros.
NNRC on the coverage, too.
Yeah, that was awesome. I was super pumped. I hope that our comments about EFRA didn't mess that up, but I was supposed to go back to do this.
You can't back off now.
No.
We'll make progress.
You know what, though? And it's also been two great weekends of racing for European racing. That's another great thing as well. You know, just having that back. I've missed it a lot. I really have. It's good to see. Good to see. And, yeah, man, it's good. Look at you. Yeah, a little smile coming up there. Yeah, man, yeah. No, yeah. It's no longer underdog. Trying to be top dog, you know? But act like top dog. So, yeah, man, it's awesome. Thank you to all those people, man. Thank you to everybody. Thank you to everybody. JQ, thank you for your time. And thank you to all the NNRC squad around the world. We can't do without you guys, man. Just like Joseph said, I appreciate your support. His too, because he's part of this as well. We started this together. So, yeah, man, lots of support, lots of good things. And the invisible speed, man, I'm telling you, that's the future, though. The invisible speed is the future. People just ain't realized that yet. The online course is the future. Also, thank you to the patrons of the podcast. We can't do without you guys. Thank you for the extra support you get early release of this podcast. Shout out to Invisible Speed, TZO 200 Tires, High Tech RCD, TNR Fuels, Mayako, Beach RC, Techno RC. Check out Lugs Racing Tires. Use the promo code NNRC Lugs. You'll get 25% off your order. G-Spec RC Tuning. Also got a coupon code for that. Papa Willys for all your traction tonic needs. Got a coupon code there. Sampadao. Check them out. I'm going to be running those batteries there in my Techno build here soon. Racecraft USA. Get pitted with them. Clinic RC for all your cool stuff. RCGP, House of RC, the DRA shop, JTP RC. Thank you guys for all the continued support. Thank you, JQ. You know what? We kind of, you know, it's kind of a long road. You pushed me to get her. I had a little help getting to where that European Championship came into, along with all the people that were involved. Feels good. It feels good to win something, you know? Feels good. Feels very good. I'm pumped. I'm happy. Yeah, now we need to win with invisible speed. Remember, 20% off, people, sign up this week, and then you get the run through next week. It's worth
it. That's a win-win.
Win-win. Hey, get you some invisible speed. With that said, Nitro's the glory, E-Buggy pays the bills, Lefty, and this dude over here who's now got a European championship under his belt. We guys are out. You guys have a good weekend, all week, and thank you for the support. Yeah, man.